And I think I'm going PA.
You've made the right choice. This is Michael Cavaccini of michaelcavaccini.com, and you're listening to Michael Cavaccini's Pod of Thunder.
Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in KISS podcasting. It's your buddy, Andy. I'm joined by Chris. We are not joined by Nick, but we are joined by our friend, Chris Jericho. Welcome back, Chris.
Very excited to be here. It's really funny whenever I hear that opening song, it hypes me up. This is one of my favorite things to do. We got some pizza, we got vodka. We've got Chris L. and we've got KISS. What more do you need?
That's what you need. That's right.
And first of all, let me just, Chris, I don't want to cut you off. Who's this Michael Cavaccini son of a bitch? He's pissing me off.
Well, somehow he's gotten involved in paperwork, legal matters, taken over Pot of Thunder.
Okay, well, listen, let me tell you guys something. You guys have built this franchise. I'm not going to allow some internet troll son of a bitch, little fuckface, take over your damn show, all the hard work you've done, especially when you're near the finish line.
That's right.
So let me make a call to Stamford, Connecticut, to get the entire legal team of one Mr. Vincent K. McMahon, see if I can get them on your side, and we'll take this little bastard down.
Well, this is a good time to do this.
I always feel ripped off that you didn't go, got to tooge at the end of it.
Yeah.
Got to tooge. Got to tooge.
That one's actually Nick. So if we're going to
point
fingers, we're going to blame Nick today.
Who is not here, by the way.
Yeah, right. We're going to bury the shit out of that. That's twice in a row. He's avoiding me now.
Well, see, Nick is becoming the Neil Peart of this show. He doesn't participate in all the ancillary bullshit. He just shows up for all the actual primetime performances, and he couldn't be bothered to show up tonight.
Wow, this is ancillary bullshit.
And he still makes...
He ain't here, is he?
He still makes one-third of the profits, too, which is the thing that really pisses me off.
You know? Not fair. But actually, in his absence, he sent someone. Do you guys see this? Mm-hmm. Look at this here. Let me pull this cover off here.
What am I looking at?
Yep. Hey, guys. It's me, Gnarly Nick, the garlic robot.
There's a robot, Nick.
He's a garlic robot, he said?
Yeah, he's a garlic robot.
Okay.
Great.
As if he... Well, I'm here because the real Nick is in the kitchen. He's really busy baking a chocolate chip zucchini bread.
Okay.
So that's more important. That's more important than being here today.
Apparently. All right. Can I give you guys a little zucchini story?
Sure.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. We love
So when I was like a kid, I went to a family picnic. Much like the one, you went to family pictures. This is a family picnic.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was eating these brownies that my aunt made.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved the brownies. I had three or four of them. They were great. And then I found out that it had zucchini in it.
Yeah.
And it never, like, I didn't want to eat it. Like, well, you liked it when you didn't know it was zucchini. No, you don't understand. There's no place for chocolate mixed with zucchini. They're two separate food groups. They're two separate vibes. Zucchini means vegetables, means blah.
Yeah.
Chocolate means fun times. It's dessert. You can't mix the two.
I don't disagree with you. And apparently that's what Nick's doing now. So
what
do we think of him?
I think Nick's a son of a bitch too.
I think
that makes two of them.
You're onto something.
Yeah, I'm not down with that combination.
At least when you missed Chris L, you were on vacation with your lovely wife.
I was.
And now it's twice Nick has avoided me.
Mm-hmm.
I think he has a problem with me.
He might be linked up with this Cavaccini guy.
Yeah.
There might be a power struggle going on.
Could be a little of a mutiny going on. This could be like Warren DeMartini's rat versus Stephen Piercy's rat versus Bobby Blotch's rat.
Right.
It's going to be Pot of Thunder versus Pot of Thunder featuring Nick and Cavaccino.
Yeah, could be. You know, for now, I'm just going to chalk it up to him being the Neil Peart of this operation.
That's not bad.
He's just not interested in the extra stuff. So, you know. Andy is and it? I are the Getty and Alex. We do the meet and greets. We do the road shows, all this stuff.
What am I, like the John Rutsy then? Or what?
John Rutsy? No.
Do you know who that is?
Yeah, I know who that is. Yeah. You're right. More like the, who's...
Dave Grohl, maybe?
No, who's their producer? Brown?
Nick Raskolnikov. Oh,
Terry Brown. Brown.
Or, like or Ray Terry Daniels, Brown. Their manager.
Yeah, there you go.
I could be like Ray Daniels. Yeah. I should manage you guys.
I think you should.
I'm already defending you legally.
Yeah.
And I'll manage you.
Why not?
I'll manage you out of this shitty situation.
Yeah, topple Cavaccini. That's the new hashtag.
Yeah, exactly. Hashtag topple Cavaccini. What's going on, America's little brother?
Oh, man, just holding it down over here, keeping things moving. And good news. Mm. I see someone coming down the hall.
Oh, my goodness.
See?
You have a doorbell on this hotel room.
We did. We have one installed.
Who would think?
It's good because, you know, the last couple of times, I don't think we had any merch delivered, and you felt kind of ripped off.
I did, yeah. That felt last time you guys really undermined me because you did your own version of Exciter and then just had me along as like the redheaded stepchild that you had to play with because your mom made you.
Yeah. We didn't feel good about that.
Yeah, I didn't feel good about it either. I was still pissed off about it, even though Chris L. thought it was funny to pull a scam on me, to pull a little rib on me.
I was surprised at your reaction, but we won't make it.
Are you going to do it again to me today?
No.
We're doing a Kiss song, right?
Yes.
Not going to pull Fred the Bear or some bullshit.
No,
Fred the Bear.
I just said we're not going to make that mistake twice.
All right, cool.
No, we can't do that.
You know, I learned my own lesson again today when we had our VIP meet and greet, and we always do a little concert for them.
Yeah.
And I asked them today if they had any requests, and they're asking for all these stupid songs. I said, see, this is why you never give the fans control of the show.
That's right.
Once again,
that from you. It happened again today.
I need to learn from myself. It happened today. So that's a perfect example.
So what was
example.
The stupidest song they
asked wasn't
for.
Stupid. They were all good. They were asking for really obscure Fozzy songs. You know, like, play Broken Soul or play like Brides of Fire, like these really weird songs from like four albums ago that we've never played live.
Yeah.
And where everyone's just standing there doing nothing.
We can't do that.
No, we need, we're choosing the song and you're going
to
like it.
Yeah, so that's the way to go. Yeah.
That's got to be kind of flattering, though. I think that's pretty cool when you have hardcore fans who want the deep cuts.
It is. We were just hoping that they would say something that we actually know how to play. So
right.
There you go.
Yeah.
So maybe I should be blaming my own band rather than the fans.
Why don't we know how to play?
How
any
do we
of
know
these?
How to play any of our own songs?
Yeah. Exactly. Right. Well, I don't feel like getting up, so let's send Robot Nick
shit,
over.
Oh shit! The door. Yeah.
Yeah. Robot Nick's gonna go over there and fetch this thing. Here.
Sure. Let me go fetch that package.
There you go. See, he listens.
Unlike the human Nick, doesn't listen to anything.
Maybe we should get the garlic Nick to host the show.
Garlic Nick.
Well, we might as well ask him this. Oh my God.
Who's this from?
Let's find out. Is it from who we want it to be from?
Who do you
the large breasted girl at the front desk?
Let me flip it over here and see. It's from the Double Platinum Club.
Oh, good. Okay. We got a piece of merchandise from the Double Platinum Club. This is what you want. This is the real Pot of Thunder experience.
I want the full 360 here. Don't tell me you're going to do another version of whatever song we're going to do when he comes
that
back.
That was all Chris, so point your anger to the man next to you.
Look at him throwing me under the bus.
I couldn't throw you under the bus faster.
All right, so it's the Double Platinum Collection. Right. What is it, socks?
So what we've got here, it's a VHS tape.
Ooh.
Mm, okay. Let's see.
I was a Betamax guy back in the
Jeez,
day.
Jeez, bad call.
Always on the wrong side
they didn't
of history.
Were you into in television as well?
Kind of. I mean.
That didn't last very
long
either.
I've always been on the wrong side of history with those things.
Wrong side of the tracks.
It's like I have a plasma TV that I love. When that thing goes tits up, I'm done. You know?
This thing's as huge. If that falls on you, you're going to die. It's right. Like 150 pounds.
So what? It's a much superior picture, but because of the fucking rubes out there who can't appreciate quality, the whole technology's gone.
Do you watch your laser discs on it?
I'd like to. They would look great. But once that one goes...
done.
Yeah. Once it gives up the ghost, I'm done. I have to look at an inferior picture for the rest of my life.
It's a shitty future.
Yeah, exactly.
It is a shitty future.
What a terrible life.
And it's all because of the fucking rubes out there who can't appreciate quality. Oh, it's too heavy. Fucking lift a weight.
It is fairly heavy, though.
Jesus Christ.
Jeez, man.
Is there really a difference?
It's like a piece of furniture, like a plasma TV.
Right. Once you set it down on the fucking stand, you don't have to worry about it anymore.
Well, it is a stand. Isn't it its own stand?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Which is another plus, because you can't you can't mount that shit over your fireplace. It's like, no TVs over the fireplace, asshole.
What does that bother you?
You don't like that?
Appreciate the fireplace for what it is, not as a base for your fucking TV.
Jeez, man. Okay, so we know Chris loves fireplaces.
He doesn't like disrespect to fireplaces.
I don't like it, as a matter of fact. It's a faux pas.
What if
don't
you put books above the fireplace? Is that allowed? Or?
It's better. Than a damn TV.
Hmm.
Plus, it's a wrong view.
I wouldn't want to have a TV above the fireplace, because if the fire is going, you want to watch the fire, and then you might not be watching the TV.
Exactly right.
You know what I mean?
Which is also the reason why you don't have a TV in the bedroom.
Why?
So you could watch the fire?
The bedroom is for doing two things.
What?
Sleeping and fucking.
Wow.
No TV watching in there.
I bet you Paul Stanley would agree with that. Paul might have even said that at some point.
Mm-hmm. Good for him. Yeah. We all know Paul knows best. So anyway, best. That's my lecture for today.
Okay, well, so we have a VHS tape here from The Postman.
Yes, and it is the sequel to the Paul Stanley workout.
Wow.
Wow.
I like that one. For dirty minds and clean bodies.
All right, so what it says here is that it begins with the end climax of the Paul Stanley workout.
The debilitating climax, so, if you will.
I guess so, yeah. So this is the Paul Stanley post-workout cool-down VHS tape. Want to pop it in for a second?
Please, yeah, please do.
Let's do this. Here we go.
Pop it into what?
He has a VHS here, too.
It came with a VCR.
Use your imagination, Chris. Oh, come on, man.
Come on.
We'll keep it away from the fireplace.
So you just got done working out, I guess.
Right into Ain't Quite Right.
Yeah. Some deep breaths.
Is he showering?
What kind of workout is this?
Great bass line of this song.
Oh, that's another sleeper song I really liked.
Yeah.
He's making a smoothie now, according to himself. Yeah. Post-workout.
It's terrible. I just want to hear Ain't Quite Right right now.
Yeah. Hmm. It's good. Okay. That's just a little sample. We don't have time to play the whole thing.
Or the desire.
That too.
That one might have missed the mark a little bit, but I thought it'd be like, oh, yeah, I'm going to have myself a little shake after my workout. You know what I'm talking about.
Well, now you have this idea.
You know, Paul Stanley has a bad workout. You know, he needs to give some relief to his aching muscles.
Mm-hmm.
So he might be walking in a hotel and say, hey, I saw you in the hotel getting ice. Can I have some? So you actually heard Paul Stanley say that?
We did, in Indianapolis in 2000.
Why was a while he ago. Saying that?
I don't know. We don't.
Like, what kind of hotel is Kiss staying at that some dude is going to be staying in? They're staying at the Waldorf Astoria.
Right.
Ain't no Kiss fans staying at the Waldorf Astoria.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, he pointed to someone in the crowd. He said, I saw you back at the hotel. I saw you in the hallway getting ice. And then he did a Paul Stanley hug himself pose, turned around.
So we played in Fargo last Sunday. It's the first show we ever had in Fargo. And I saw Kiss there because we used to go to Fargo to see shows that didn't come to Winnipeg.
Oh, okay.
And all I remember about the show was the Hot in the Shade tour. It was actually a great show, but all I remember is Paul constantly yodeling Fargo. Fargo, whoa, 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 whoa. All right, Fargo, whoa, 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 whoa.
What year was this?
1990.
Okay.
And I just kept saying that the whole time. All right, Fargo, whoa, 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 whoa.
How'd that go over with the crowd?
Well, I explained what it was, and they went nuts because everything I do is amazing.
Well, okay, good.
Thank you. Not bad for a C-level star.
Oh, he still remembers that.
That was from the first time.
That was a couple of years ago.
Let's go through quickly the sure. Jericho episodes. Mm-hmm. So was that really a couple of years ago?
I think it was 2 years ago. It was September.
It's been a while.
And what did we start with? Thrills on the Night?
No, we Turn on the Night.
Turn
was
on
first.
Was that first?
Yeah.
Wow, Turn on the Night was first.
Mm-hmm. Then I'm still sober. I remember. If you ask me in like 20 minutes, I might not remember.
The last time you start calling me Tooge. so we did Thrills of the Night. Okay, so we don't have to do these in order, but we did
Turn on the Night, Thrills of the Night.
Domino.
Domino.
Vinnie Vincent Nation. Boys Gonna Rock.
Mm-hmm. Shocker.
Shocker.
Which I was not a part of.
Right. Exciter.
Yeah.
And now whatever song is. So it's been seven. That's not bad.
Oh, that's pretty good.
You guys have done 250 episodes. I've been on seven of them.
Yeah.
I'm a little piece of the Pot of Thunder history.
Yeah. Not definitely.
Bad. Thank you.
Seven.
Little piece, yet a big piece.
Yeah.
I like when people draw pictures of you guys and I'm like the fourth guy.
That does happen
it
sometimes.
It does. It's cool. Yeah. I'm like the Mark St. John of Pot of Thunder.
All right. So we got to figure out how this VHS tape interacts with the random song generator. But first, we got to turn that thing on.
Yeah.
So let's fire it up.
Let's do it.
Throw an ice bucket at it from across the room because we brought it with today. It's in the parking lot.
What if Paul Stanley saw us getting ice?
Could. He could be here.
I was at Fort Wayne the other day.
There it is.
I like this one. Watch out. I like that one. That might be my favorite song that you guys have done.
Really?
Yeah.
That is powerful, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that machine's out of control.
Barreling toward the finish line.
So I'm happy that you were able to bring the sports machine to Fort Wayne, Indiana.
Mm-hmm.
I know it's a little bit of a trek. It
yeah,
takes a while to set it up. It's much bigger than a plasma TV.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had to tow it behind the vehicle.
I saw that, yeah.
Yep.
And the lady with the big boobs at the front desk helped us bring it up and assemble it.
She helped us bring a few things up.
Oh, come
on.
I'm
talking about. But, you know, it's all right.
Let's start this examination just a little bit early.
Yeah. It's the kind of welcome we expect when we roll into cheap hotels.
When we roll into Fort Wayne.
Yeah.
This isn't a cheap hotel. The one we stayed at last time was much cheaper.
Yeah.
You know what?
This hotel is actually not bad. They got an indoor-outdoor pool over there.
You know what hotel that we're staying at?
Which one, Chris?
The only hotel that'll let us stay.
Woo!
My whole rhetoric is Kiss Animalized on this uncensored show.
If you could just not even speak in any real sentences for the rest of the show.
Just do that. There's lines from that show that can use in any capacity. I watched it all the time. I watched it last night, but I was really drunk. So by the time we started watching it, I was gone. So I remember seeing Detroit Rock City and the super fast cold gin, super fast Creatures of the Night, and then I fell asleep.
You didn't make it to this baby.
His little baby.
And
nothing better than illegitimate baby jokes.
Yeah.
I said that to Paul once. I said, you got to love the 80s. Illegitimate baby jokes were like all the rage.
Yeah.
He's never seen you before in his life.
He's like, I'm not taking care of that baby. Laughing.
Yeah.
I don't care if it is mine.
let me tell you something, Detroit. That baby had the longest fucking tongue I ever seen. And Gene's like, what? Yeah, sorry. I fucked her.
Yeah. I don't care. You're not getting any money from me.
Exactly.
Loser.
Yeah. Yeah, little bastard child.
Yeah. All right, so this VHS tape, right? We're just going to connect it with whatever these are, the red, yellow, white cables that nobody uses anymore because they're not HD. So let's do this, and Robot Nick's going to connect it.
Okay.
This one comes off!
Blizzard of Oz.
It's called
No Bone Movie.
What is this?
What the hell is that? Is that Cavaccini?
That can't be right. I think that was Robot Nick pulling.
Oh, that's Nick's mad because we said No Bone Movies wasn't a good song.
Yeah, he's furious. Still.
It's not a good song. I mean, it's okay, but it's like Rich Ward said, the slide guitar solo by Randy Rhoads. Give me a fucking break.
That's one of Nick's all time favorites.
Oh, it just sounds like they're hanging around jamming. It'd be like if the three of us picked up a guitar and started writing a song.
Wow.
Do you know what a bone movie is, Chris?
No, I don't.
A porno.
Okay.
Yeah, I never knew.
No pornos?
Yeah, no.
It's like an anti-porno song.
Yeah.
Why would that be? Why would
anybody
put out it?
Apparently, back in like 81 or whatever, Spectrovision was just starting. Remember Spectrovision? You would go to a hotel room like this.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And there was no phones with internet. So if you wanted to, you know, snap one out, you would order a porno off of Spectrovision, which was what the name of the movie thing was. Also known as Spanktrovision.
Right.
So apparently Ozzy was watching too many pornos, spending too much money on Spanktrovision in the hotel rooms. Sharon caught wind of it and said, no more bone movies.
Okay.
So there you go.
Got it.
I never knew that.
Yeah,
so it was more her laying down the law, and he's like, that's a good name for a song.
Yeah, you know, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Silver Screen, Such a Disgrace, right? All that stuff. It's just.
Yeah, it's total no bone movies.
Yeah. There you go. All right, here, let's get this robot to do this again. Come on.
Oh, well, something went wrong.
It sure did.
This one comes off.
Kiss box set.
It's what? Called
Time Traveler.
Oh, my gosh. Time Traveler.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Right. Now, let me just say something here. I know about Time Traveler, but this is very rare, Chris.
This is.
I have never heard this song in my life, and I am the biggest Kiss fan, just like you guys. I know every Kiss song, but I've never heard this song, so I'm very excited to be a part of this.
So how did this one elude you?
I think it was one of those like completed demos for one of the records, which I'm sure Andy will tell us.
Right.
And it was only on the box set. And
I never got around to listening to it?
I might have listened to it once, but the box set, you buy it just basically to have it. You know, I'm not going to put on, you know, CD number 4 with 18 songs that I've heard and Time Traveler stuck right in the middle of it.
Yeah,
right?
That's kind of how it works.
That's exactly how it works. So give us some information on this.
Well, okay, so Paul Stanley wrote and recorded material for a solo album in 1987, 1988, around that time.
So after Crazy Nights.
Mm-hmm. He shelved it. Didn't happen, right? So a couple songs. Some of these titles are Don't Let Go, When Two Hearts Collide.
Oh, boy.
Those, you can find those as bootlegs. But the only official song from that project that's been released is this version of Time Traveler, which technically is a demo, quote unquote, but it's also on an official Kiss release, this box set, so we're counting it.
This is technically a Paul Stanley solo song, too.
Yep. So he was working. It looked like he was, you know.
This is exciting. Wow. I'm really excited about this.
And I kind of we've had this discussion before, I think, that some of the stuff on Hot in the Shade, I mean, that basically was.
They're all demos.
Solo album, almost. Anyway,
yeah, they're all demos that whoever recorded them had, wherever buddies were available to play on it.
So that's basically the direction they were going
in. So this could have been on Hot in the Shade.
So it could have been on Hot in the Shade. Some of that stuff could have been on the Paul solo album if that did happen.
Which it didn't.
Which it didn't, right? But, I mean.
Wow, so we have because I wonder, was it Sword and Stone?
Yeah, that's another one people talk about.
I think that one was actually on the Crazy Nights sessions.
Yeah.
Ron Nevison didn't like.
That didn't make it, but that's another.
But other people did that song. No one's ever done Time Traveler.
No. So here's some more information about Time Traveler. Okay. Co-written by Desmond Child with Paul Stanley.
I know I'm going to love it.
Yeah,
he's
right?
The man.
That's Desmond and Paul never wrote a bad song.
That's the precise elixir, right, Chris?
Yeah.
Never wrote a bad song.
Yeah. So we've got Paul Stanley playing guitar, bass, and singing. Bruce Kulick's on lead.
Nice.
And some guy named Phil Ashley's on keyboards.
Okay.
Who's drumming, Eric?
Well, we'll get into that.
Okay.
Wow.
So Paul said, in 1986, I set up equipment to do basic demos in my apartment in New York, and Time Traveler was one of them. This track was submitted for Crazy Nights. Okay, well, that just, you know, that doesn't work with the story I just told you, but edit that out.
And Bruce.
Didn't fit the personality of the album. Okay, so this doesn't fit Crazy Nights.
It's overblown keyboards and pop melodies?
Yeah, that works for me. Mm-hmm. I'm already excited about it.
Because it doesn't fit Crazy Nights? Okay. Like some other songs, it certainly has an 80s feel. Still, I like the vibe of the lyrics, and overall, I like the vocal. So I guess maybe we could say this was, I don't know, maybe he's just doing demos that didn't make it, and then he thought, put it on my maybe solo album, maybe not. It's in my pile of songs that I still like, but don't know if it's going anywhere. We're just speculating now.
Well, it's like I said, I know that definitely Paul's material carried the Crazy Nights record.
Yeah.
And he did have Sword and Stone submitted, which is a great song,
mm-hmm.
but Ron Nevison didn't like that one either, so for whatever reason.
Yeah.
Can I just say something about time songs with Kiss?
Yeah.
When I first bought Kiss Alive 2, it starts off with Detroit Rock City.
Yes.
And the next song is King of the Nighttime World. But the way that it's written, because the song title is so long, it's split into King of the Night Time World.
Next line is Time
World. So I thought it was
right.
Detroit Rock City, King of the Night, and Time World. And then when King of the Night went straight into Ladies Room, I thought that my cassette version had ripped me off and wasn't including Time World.
Like, where's Time World?
Where's Time World? Yeah, so Time Traveler could be the sequel to Time World.
This could be it.
If it actually existed.
All right. We can listen to it with that.
With that in mind?
Yeah, with that in mind.
Did I ever... Well, I've talked about it on the show. You might not have
noticed. I've heard every episode.
Have
almost.
You? So then you've heard my story of my Alive 2 screw up on the 8-track version.
Tell me again.
So I was all excited. Went and got the 8-track. 2 8-track set. So 2 cartridges and
right.
1 cardboard sleeve.
Yeah.
You remember that
yep.
shit? So I took the cartridges out. On the back, they both had the sticker for sides 3 and 4. So I'm like, fuck, I got 2 of the same cartridges.
Oh, no.
What happened to the first 2 sides? Turns out one of them was mislabeled, so I had all the music, but the wrong sticker
wow.
was on the back of one. So when I initially opened it up, I was like, God damn it, I'm going to have to take this back. I popped it in. And it played.
And you heard Detroit Rock City
yeah.
straight into King
so
of the Night.
So it was all good, but, you know,
you
initially
a,
I was disappointed.
You had a rare misstep.
Yeah.
The whole concept of 8-tracks.
Terrible.
And for kids listening today, the millions of kids listening right now that don't know what an 8-track is, it's the most awkward form of audio ever.
That's the worst.
Because what it would do is you would put the 8-track in. And it would, like you said, side 3 and 4, but it'd be program 1, program
right.
2, program 3, program 4. And the program would be like a segment, I guess. And when that program ended, it didn't matter if it was in the middle of a song. You
They'd
would be
fade
listening
it
to
out.
A song. It would be like, oh, lick it up, lick it up. Oh. And then it would go.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's only right now, lick it up. So it'd fade out and then fade back in again. So you could be jamming out to a song and then it's got this fucking pause right
well,
in the middle of it with a fade out.
Yeah, you brought up Ladies Room. That was cut in half on the Alive 2 8-track version.
Wow.
You know, it's like you'd hear the cowbell and then it'd fade out. It's like, what the fuck is this? And then, you know, yes. And
it meet you in the Ladies Room.
Very rare was the 8-track player that had any sort of rewind or fast forward function on it either. He had to play, it let the whole fucking thing play.
Wow.
Terrible,
very awkward.
Terrible media.
Very awkward. We're not going to bring back 8-tracks
no,
and all this
never.
Nostalgia.
Have you seen that?
People wearing fanny packs now.
Yeah.
We're not bringing back the 8-track.
No, the hipsterism must stop at the cassette. It can't.
I think Cheap Trick a couple years ago put out their new record in 8-track.
I think Ghost put out their latest album.
So they could say
they
had the biggest selling 8-track of the year.
Yeah.
Sold 1.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, was it their live album or
I
was
think
it?
So.
Yeah, Ghost did an 8-track version.
Were you gonna, but once again, like were you going to listen to it?
You're not. You just buy it. And
just buy it for like
cool.
the box set. You just buy it just to have it.
Just to have it.
That's not bad.
If you have an old working 8-track player laying around, I suppose it
probably
could
on eBay or something.
I guess, but I mean, you could just listen to the album on your phone. So
yeah pretend
really
it's on 8-track.
Is it really worth going through all the trouble? Just hold the 8-track.
Actually, Mike Portnoy went through a phase where he was collecting 8-tracks.
Really?
Yeah. So Mike Portnoy, maybe he has an 8-track.
Collecting
player.
Them just to have them.
Just to have them.
Yeah.
Just for fun.
Yeah, I kind of wish I had my old collection, but that's one of the things
the
that
first,
went bye-bye.
The first album I ever bought was an 8-track.
Yeah,
it was a Beach Boys record called Summer Fun.
Ooh.
And it was the best of the Beach Boys, and I bought it off a TV commercial where you would send in your self-addressed stamped envelope or whatever, and you would wait 6 to 8 weeks
yeah,
to
oh
get
my
your
God.
Your album to come in, and it was the Beach Boys Summer Fun.
Things have changed.
There
huh?
you go. Somebody asked me that today. What was the first album you ever bought? And that's the story I told them. So twice in one day.
There you go.
I'm telling the story of Beach Boys Summer Fun, just as riveting both times.
Yeah,
Chris, what was the first album you ever bought?
Rock and Roll Over on 8-track.
Nice.
And, well, it was, see, I had 8-tracks because my cousin gave me his old 8-track player. It was my first ever stereo unit on which I could listen to my own music. My parents had a turntable, one of those record players that was a piece of furniture.
Yeah.
You know, a big fucking
like
table and
TV.
You lift it up. Yeah, exactly. But.
Yeah.
Cousin gave me the 8-track player. First day I went to the record store, Harmony House in the Detroit area. Mm. And I bought 2 8-tracks, Rock and Roll Over by Kiss, Rock and Roll Music by the Beatles.
Nice.
And I was
kept
like,
with the rock and roll face.
Yeah, I want some rock and roll. These two are going to fit the bill.
It says it right
yes,
on the box.
They did.
Right.
You want to know what Rock and Roll Over means?
I do.
I asked Paul what that meant. And
I think you told us this before.
Did I tell you this? Am I getting into that category?
Go again.
I probably was much fresher on my mind when I told you before, but I think it meant like rock, like you are having sex,
mm-hmm.
like you're rocking with the girl,
mm-hmm.
and yes. when you're done, you roll over. Like rock and roll over and go to sleep.
We've all done it.
Yeah. There you go.
Once again, Paul knows best.
Yeah. It's a good title. You know, I was thinking the first cassette. Thanks for asking, by the way. First cassette I ever bought, it was either Asylum.
Wow.
On cassette. Not
Is that a cassette?
Yes, it was. Yeah. Or I remember this story. I'm still embarrassed by this experience, but our oldest brother, Jay, would, you know, oldest brothers do pick on us and embarrass us and stuff. We were at this record store. And he had already bought Metal Church, The Dark.
Yeah. And he's, ton of bricks.
Yeah. And he's like, hey, go ask the guy for Metal Church, The Light. And I was like, six. I was like, okay, I did. And the guy laughed at me. And then I looked, my brother was laughing. So to this day, I'm still embarrassed. What a little douche I was.
All right. So, so I went and saw the first time I saw Metallica in 1986. 10 weeks after Cliff Burton died, they came to town with Jason Newsted, and the opening band was Metal Church. And standing beside me, watching Metal Church, were the Mentors.
Oh, yeah,
in full regalia.
Love it,
because I guess they had a show that night or whatever. Like the black Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah,
was it El Duce? Whatever.
Yes, El Duce.
And I was like, what the
sicky
hell?
Wife beater.
Yeah. I don't know if it was sicky or not, but there's three of them. And I remember watching Metal Church out of one eye and El Duce and Sicky Wifebeater of the other eye going, what the?
Did like, you know who they were at the time?
Well, because I knew the Mentors because I had seen their album title. Like, you know, you look through the albums at the record
see
store
the
and see the stupid. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I never bought it or heard a song by them, but I knew who they were. But so that's the Metal Church Mentors connection.
That's good.
And we played a show in Seattle a few years ago, and Duke from Metal Church showed up, and I was super freaking out.
Oh, wow.
And everyone's like, fuck, dude, who cares?
You're like,
that's Duke Erickson, man. He played on The Dark.
Right.
And The Light.
The Light. There you go. All right. So, are you guys ready?
I'm excited.
This is pretty long. It's 4 minutes, 57 seconds.
Wow. A little bit of an epic.
We better get to work here.
We better. We got a long way to go.
All right. Let's do it.
Let me just say this time frame to me is Paul's best vocal period.
Yeah.
Like his singing, like whether you like Crazy Nights or not, Chris L., like his singing was so high, like a song like My Way or something. Like the
I was just going to bring up My Way. I know I remember not caring for the song, but the power of the vocal performance is undeniable.
There's a great YouTube clip of just that vocal, like the isolated vocal.
Yeah.
So high, so powerful. So I'm really excited to hear this. Paul's my guy, and the 80s Kiss is my jam, and there's a Paul 80s song I've never heard.
With Desmond Child.
With Desmond Child. Where was I?
I don't know.
We even did Shocker, for God's sakes.
Yeah, we could have saved that. We could have done this first. Well, what are we doing?
No, this is perfect. Okay. The time is right.
The time is right. You guys ready?
Yep.
Hold it.
Oh.
I just remembered something. You never answered my question. Who's drumming on this? Is it Eric Carr?
Oh, yeah. You said you had something to say about that.
Well, I said we'd get into that later, so...
Well, it's not late enough.
It's not late enough, no.
What all right. Well, fuck? Oh, my gosh. Don't fight, guys.
Jesus.
You're worse than
your brother.
You're lucky this table's between us.
You're worse than your garlic brother robot guy.
Do you want to hear more from him?
Why not? Sure. Go ahead. Okay.
It's the only time we're going to hear
not?
This.
Hey, garlic robot.
Oh, excuse me, guys. I have to go. Oh. Nick needs my help in the kitchen.
Okay. Well, I guess the robot's leaving. There he goes.
You know what? Honestly, I was really pissed off at Nick for not being here. But the fact he sent in the robot garlic boy bits, I now love Nick again. So I take it back. Yeah. I don't want to fight him.
Okay.
I don't think he's out to get me. I actually really enjoy garlic boy.
Again, it's he's the Neil Peart.
That's fine. Yeah, that's cool, man. I can take that. It's kind of mysterious, man.
I mean, you've seen the Beyond the Lighted Stage movie, the Tim Comerford story from Rage Against the Machine.
We just watched it a couple weeks ago. Well, remind me. I remember sitting in a field talking about it.
The bass player from Rage Against the Machine is like, you know, he was somehow had finagled his way into Neil Peart's area backstage and just started going all fanboy on him.
Yeah.
He said Neil Peart just went completely silent and had him escorted out of the area. I mean, that's how funny is that?
Here's a great one too. The late Nick Menza, Megadeth drummer, possibly the best drummer too. He sent a message to Neil Peart. It's like, hey, my name is Nick Menza. I'm in Megadeth. I'd really love to come meet you after the show. Please let me know. And Neil Peart sent a message back to him saying, hello, Nick from Megadeth. Have a great mega life.
That's it. Wow. So it's leave me alone.
Yeah. See, exactly. Nick is becoming the Neil Peart of Pot of Thunder.
All right.
It's nothing personal. He's just, you know, he picks and chooses what he wants to participate in.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. He's like Tommy Lee at a Motley Crue meet and greet. Refuses to show up.
Really? That's another thing?
Refuses. Hmm. Yeah. Here we go. Time Traveler.
Yes, let's get
by
into
Paul
it.
Stanley and Kiss.
And now, can you assure me that at some point you're gonna answer my question?
We're not gonna let it go, Chris.
I will answer it. Your question will be answered. How's that?
Okay. Great. Can't wait.
Vagaries. So, more vagaries for me.
I like how you're wearing Star Child socks too.
Oh yeah, thanks.
Very nice. Good job, America's little brother.
That's right. It's all a whole package.
Play the shit. Stop. Reminds me of the beginning of Rainbow in the Dark.
Yeah.
There's no drum hit, though.
That's right.
Just pure guitar on this
good
one.
Good call.
That is guitar, right? I mean, it's a nice sounding guitar.
I think it was guitar, bass, and maybe a synth as well.
Yeah.
It's layered. It's
nice sound. Kind of heavy. So good, right. Good tidings ahead.
Good 2 seconds of action.
Yeah. See, with Nick's spirit is in the room. He's notorious for stopping songs like a half second
okay,
into it.
I won't do
it's
it
like,
again.
What are you going to say about this?
I just wanted to say the Rainbow in the Dark comment. That's it. So
that's good though. It's I feel like Nick's here, and the robot's gone too now. So we need all the Nick we can get.
Okay.
That's almost Rush-like.
I was going to say Saga.
Saga, yeah.
Saga. What's the song?
On the Loose?
Yeah. I'm on the... Yeah, very Rush. It's Canadian prog.
Yeah,
Prism.
Exactly.
Saga. Rush. Triumph.
Oh, I'm blanking on that other Saga song that was on MTV all the time.
I'm on the Loose. Yeah.
Lined him up or something like that.
I'm the flyer.
That's it. Yeah. Those guys. That guitar player. He wore his fucking guitar up right under his chin. It's like, dude, come on. Have a little swag, would you? But no. I'm blanking on the Rush song. It's reminding me of. But that synth sounds like the Rush of the period.
It's also a little bit of Turn Me Loose, Loverboy.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
What's your opinion of Loverboy?
Well, I'm Canadian, so I love Loverboy. The thing with Loverboy is there was a couple other Canadian bands that came around at the same time. There was a band called Streetheart.
Okay.
That was... Actually, Paul Dean from Loverboy started them. They were 100 times better than Loverboy, but didn't have the same management. Loverboy got through the cracks and made it in the States. So, yeah, I love Loverboy, but they weren't the best band of that genre from Canada. That's
okay.
The only detriment I can
That's
say.
That's fine.
You?
Me? Get Lucky, one of the great albums of all time.
Good call.
It is a great fucking album. Great cover.
Great cover. Great, great title.
Yeah, the
only
whole
the
thing.
Lucky ones.
You know, Paul Dean had a great guitar tone. The keyboards on that album was great.
Great bass
Every
lines.
Song is great.
The fact that the bass player got lost at sea.
Yes, he's the Amelia Earhart of rock and roll. Just vanished.
Here's a good sea. One. I used to have on my answer machine. I would say, "Hey, this is Chris. I'm not here right now, but leave the name of your favorite Loverboy song, and I'll call you back." So people would call, and some people didn't know what to do. And I get a call one day. Yes, this is Vince McMahon. I do not have a favorite Loverboy song, but I would appreciate if you call me back immediately. And I was like, oh, okay. Better change the answer machine.
Yeah.
Vince raining on my Loverboy parade.
Isn't Nick a big fan of Loving Every Minute of It?
Yeah.
That's a good song.
It is a good song.
They had a lot of good songs. Notorious.
How about the video to Notorious?
Great,
Was that another bathroom scrambler?
Yeah.
Oh, by the way,
you've heard my story of the Hot Girls in Love video.
No.
You know how much of my mom's hand lotion got used up after that video had come out?
Hot Girls in Love is another great song.
Yeah, man. That dude, blonde I gotta tell chick you too, in that? Oh, God.
Dude, I was fucking howling when you were talking about the Billy Squire video.
Well.
Rock Me Tonight, when you were talking about his elbows to his torso. Yeah. It's such a, that's the best. Well, that's the best. And then I ended up talking to Corey Taylor about that from Slipknot, and we were talking about how he was talking about some dances. He said, are you going to dance like Billy Squire in the Rock Beats Tonight video? And he instantly got, career killer. I'm like, yeah. Everyone knows that was the end of Billy Squire.
Everybody knows it. Some people try to deny it, but it's
elbows to the torso. Yeah. That made me laugh out loud. As you guys know, I always ride my bike on the trail near my house. I ride 15 miles, and I either listen to Keeping It 100 by Conan podcast or you guys if it's a song that I like. Mm-hmm. And I was fucking, I had to pull over on the bike. I was laughing so hard. Elbows to the torso.
But yeah, Notorious, the Loverboy video. It's one of the great TNA 80s videos.
Oh, I have to go check it out then. And Hot Girls in Love, I'll watch that too.
Well, that's another good one. It's okay. Not overtly TNA, but that chick is smoking hot in that video.
All right.
I might have to scramble off to the bathroom right now.
Hurry, cue the song. Oh, that's such a drum machine. It sounds like freaking a like Survivor or something.
It's like Survivor. It's almost like the Baywatch theme a little bit,
the
too.
The drums are, yeah. There's the answer to you who played drums. Yeah. Nobody.
Nobody.
Really?
Yeah,
it's a drum machine?
It's a drum machine. Such a drum machine.
Oh, well, there you go. Yeah. Definitely very 80s, but so, I mean, I'm liking the melody of
I'm liking
chord
it already.
Changes. You know?
I'm liking it because it's 80s Paul Stanley with Desmond Child. I'm already giving it a thumbs up or whatever the fucking thing you guys had. Give me a hallelujah already.
I gotta pull some lyrics
from
up,
the sweat on my back.
I didn't know if he said from the or you're the. I don't know what.
Let me just say this as you look at the lyrics. Paul, the reason why Kiss made it through the 80s is because Paul was built for this type of music. He what? Really embraced the 80s synth and pop sensibilities and the whole thing. And you might say, like, he was copying. He wasn't copying. This is Paul Stanley.
Yeah.
Like, he loves Led Zeppelin and all that stuff. But when they crested into the 80s, he used to hang out at Studio 54. He loves this style of music.
Absolutely. It's genuine coming from him.
And that's why I buy it. Like, other bands that, like, you know, you mentioned Loudness or Saxon or all those bands that were heavy and then sold out for the Raven. It was just, it wasn't real. This is real Paul Stanley. This is who he is. Mm-hmm.
The only other 70s band that made the transition as successfully as Kiss, in my opinion, was Scorpions.
Scorpions, I mean, much.
Those guys embraced that whole Sunset Strip
scene. They sure
scene
did.
And it, but they blended in perfectly.
But let's throw Van Halen in there. And what do they incorporate? More keyboards. ZZ Top.
Yeah,
more keyboards.
That's
Rush,
true.
More keyboards.
Yeah.
And it
well,
was
Rush was never a sleaze rock.
No, but they definitely changed with the times of less guitar, bass, you know.
Oh, no,
fuels.
I agree with you there.
They incorporated what was going on at the time and made it their own.
No, you're
like
right.
ZZ Top, I mean, Eliminator and Afterburner, the hugest records they ever had.
Sure.
They're completely a different galaxy from LaGrange
absolutely.
And Tube Snake Boogie and all that sort of stuff, right?
Plus those albums, you want to talk about pure drum machine. There wasn't a live drummer on
not,
those albums
not
either.
Not one.
But I get what you're saying, but I'm talking about like embracing the whole Sunset Strip, sleaze rock thing. It's Kiss and Scorpions.
Ditching the Uli John Roth headband and incorporating leather pants and, you know, hairspray.
Yes, exactly.
And making it
you
work.
You know, when passion rules the game.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Enough said.
When the podcast rules the game.
Yeah.
We'll have to close with that today.
Scorpions play the Tampa Arena tonight. They're still arena touring. incredible. Which blows my mind. I never thought Scorpions were still an arena band.
Me neither. I remember a few years ago they were with Megadeth, and I was like, who's opening? Dude, everyone's like, duh, Scorpions. I was like, really? To me, I didn't think Scorpions like slam dunk arena band. I thought
I know. And this tour, they have
co-headlining
or something? They have Queensryche opening. So that's a really small, like, not a small band, but now they
Megadeth
are.
But not Megadeth. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and they played in front of 10,000 people in Tampa.
Incredible.
That's insane.
Man. Yeah.
You know?
They were huge in the 80s.
Yeah, they were. Yeah. Underrated.
Yeah.
What do you got lyric-wise?
Lyrics. There's no doubt in my heart that we've been here before. You're the sweat on my back. I'm the lock on your door.
Is that really flattering to a woman that say you're the sweat on my back?
I don't really understand.
I'm going to go out and say that to the woman behind the desk at the lobby, see what the reaction is. Can I tell you something? You're the sweat on my back.
Yeah. I don't even really understand what that means.
Yeah, what does that mean?
Maybe
it doesn't make sense.
Maybe we'll find out more later. Maybe not.
Like we're going to find out who the drummer was?
Now, exactly. If he said, you're the sweat in my crack, that might have been
that better. Would be more.
Yeah. Let's analyze this for a second. Knowing the Paul Stanley, so you're the sweat on my back. So when you work really hard, you're sweating, right? Yeah. So maybe she's the sweat on his back because he works so hard for her. He works hard to give her pretty things. And
okay.
Causes sweat on his back.
Causes sweat, and then
she's the sweat on his back.
And he's the lock on her door, so he's like he takes care of her.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. Like the security for her.
Yeah, yeah. He's
it's
like
an interesting take. It's an interesting way to put it. I'm not too sure too many women would take that as a compliment.
I agree.
At face value.
But maybe Paul Stanley would think a girl would take that as a compliment.
And how are we going to get to him being a time traveler?
I don't know. I'm wondering. Is this going to be like? Is he going back to like medieval times or what?
What did he say?
Well, he said, and the circle's complete, and my lips find their home.
Goodness.
Now, see, I want to kiss the lips, not the ones on your face.
See, now that is something a woman would respond to. You're the sweat on my back? I don't know if that would
work. My lips have found a place. What is it? Was it?
It was, have found
my
a
lips
home.
Find their home.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
On your ass. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. You know what? This drum machine, I just realized what it reminded me of.
What?
St. Elmo's Fire, John Parr.
Who to be in a man in motion? I need a pair of wheels.
Naughty, naughty. Wasn't that his other hit?
Naughty, naughty.
He was like that.
Loud and body.
He was like the. Him and Michael Bolton were like those rocker guys who turned into.
Yeah, I would give John Parr, Michael Bolton, and John Cafferty and the Beaver Brown Band were all about the same level at that point in time.
Yeah. Which, I guess.
Please, man. Down and loud and body. What is it? Naughty, naughty, loud and body.
Yeah.
To please me.
But this drum machine is ripped off from St. Elmo's Fire theme. So.
Or need is a pair of wheels.
I'm returning to you like the wind kisses stone.
What did he say? Wait a minute.
That was weird.
Like the wind kisses what?
I'm returning to you like the wind kisses stone. What the hell?
It doesn't mean anything.
It does kind of paint a medieval times picture, but I don't know what it means.
I love how the melody of this song is so stock that the highlight of it is the overemphasized St. Elmo's Fire drum beat.
Now, but on that tip, though, it just occurred to me, do you think maybe he wrote this song with the intention of having it placed in a movie? I mean,
it sure sounds like it.
Yeah. It's definitely Scott, because we compared it to Survivor. Pretty much every one
of
St.
Elmo's Fire
was designed for a fucking Rocky movie.
You're right.
And Paul works like that sometimes. We've heard him tell stories where he has a goal in mind and he'll write for that goal.
Yeah, sure. He wanted to write a Rod Stewart song. Yeah. Like when we wanted a disco song.
Yeah.
He wrote, I Was Made for Loving. So maybe he wanted. This definitely has that vibe. You would see this at the end of Iron Eagle 2 or something.
Louis Gossett Jr. in the video.
Yeah. Or the Or the even more homoerotic version of Top Gun entitled The Sweat on My Back.
Top Gun 2, yeah. The Sweat on My Back.
I just can't get past that line. That is hilarious. When I get home tomorrow, I'm going to say that to my wife. You're the sweat on my back.
When Chris L. legitimately laughs, you know over. You got it.
Well, that's another one, because one of the things we talk about with Kiss lyrics is like, this should be a pickup line that we use at the sports bar down the street.
Yeah. Right.
You'll be in the bathroom fucking somebody 30 seconds later. Add this to the list. You're the sweat on my back. You're the sweat
I
on
love
my back.
Paul Stanley. Oh, I could never sing that lyric and make it work. Only Paul Stanley can. That's a great melody line. Wow, dude, that vocal is insane.
Yeah.
I mean, holy shit, is that good.
You got to give the guy his props for his vocal talents. You know, he takes a lot of shit, especially lately, from his bandmate Gene.
What an asshole. What an asshole thing to say, man. Yeah. What a fucking bullshit thing to say.
Yeah.
No reason for that whatsoever, man. Mm-hmm. That vocal line right there, like, all jokes aside, that's some serious singing right there. Very, very good. The arrangement with the drums in the back, not really, to me, the best choice. But if you just had the isolated vocal of that, like, that right there makes me want to hear this song again and again and again. That's really good.
Mm-hmm. And what were the lyrics he was delivering there?
Your love is a light up ahead, so deep that we can't understand. My love crosses centuries of sand. I don't know what that is. And it's straight into you. We are aging anew. So that's where...
But
hold, centuries.
Read the beginning of it again. Your love.
Your love is a light up ahead.
Right.
So deep that we can't understand.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
But a light up ahead isn't deep. It should be your love is a light up ahead. So bright.
Yeah.
That it, you know, my eyes fall out of my head.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Deep doesn't really make
sense. It's like deep doesn't fit for that. But this is very much like the Shocker lyrics. It doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense.
It just sounds cool when you sing it.
But like, my love crosses centuries of sand. That's kind of cool.
That's the time travel element. Yeah.
And we are aging anew. That's a weird line for Paul Stanley.
Anew,
song.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, this was probably written for like a movie where somebody goes back in time or the aging process starts.
Was that Christopher Reeve movie where they somewhere, is it called Somewhere in Time?
Yeah.
There you go.
I think Iron Maiden wrote Caught Somewhere in Time for that movie. Christopher Reeve extended it.
Nico McBrain was hoping he could fuck Jane Seymour by writing that. So,
it was the '80s. Anything could happen.
Hey,
you never know.
You never know.
Coked up British rock stars and a British fucking, you know, she's probably coked up too. You
if you don't ask for it, you'll never get it.
It's true.
Gotta throw it at the wall, see if it sticks.
And it's straight into you, Chris. What was the line the guy said to you at the bar that you were telling me?
What?
The guy at Kilroy's.
Oh, Kilroy's in Indianapolis?
No. A much lower level Kilroy.
We just walked past there yesterday. Okay. We saw Kilroy's in Indianapolis.
No. Because he said, "Yeah, I want you to." Because it's pretty close. He said, "It's straight into you." That's kind of like the line you told me that some guy leaned over and told you.
You're really gonna make me say it?
Did
you
not say? Was it not on the show?
I don't know. It wasn't on the show. We said it amongst ourselves.
Edit this out, maybe. Okay, I thought it was on the show before.
Edit this out.
Well, I don't
tell Jericho, for God's sakes.
We don't have to edit this out because I didn't say it. I overheard
it,
so I can relate the story. So you know all about the fact that I used to own a coffee shop with my wife. Andy's band and Nick's band played
used to
there.
Play there, yeah. That's how they became friends, right?
Yep.
So there's a bar couple blocks from the cafe called Kilroy's where I would go hang out before, you know, going to run shows over there. And so I was just, you know, sitting at the bar having a beer, and this guy next to me, the thing about this place was like, people there had no filter. They would drop the N-word, all sorts of just crazy shit to you, like, who cares? they don't even know me, and they're dropping these kind of ridiculousness, you know.
Right.
So there was a bartender. She was, you know, pretty attractive, very nice body. And, you know, as occasionally bartenders have to do, they have to turn their back to you to grab a bottle of liquor or whatever. And it was, you know, summertime, so she had a pair of jean shorts on, you know. Good look, good look. And, you know, I'm just sitting there minding my own business, and this drunk guy is over to my right. He's sitting next to me. He leans over, gets up, like his chin is almost resting on my shoulder, and he's just like leering at her, swaying back and forth, and he goes right in my ear. He goes, "I'd fuck her in the ass straight away." And I'm like, okay, do it. You be you, buddy. You
straight know? Away.
Yeah.
That's kind of, that's almost where Paul Stanley was going here. It's straight into you.
Almost like, almost a Coverdale-esque slide it in yes, kind right, of yeah. euphemism. You know, I can get on board with that, sure.
All right, big chorus coming. You guys ready?
Oh, please.
Dude, yeah, this is absolutely written for a movie, I'm convinced.
What a vocal, man. Jeez. He yeah. goes, "When the fire never dies." Like, that's great, man. Like, once again, the electronic drums are shit.
Little overbearing.
But we do have to remember that this is
a demo. Right.
Yeah, yeah, and like I said, I'm not judging it on the drums.
Yeah.
Because if you're going to be that type of an asshole, then, you know,
yeah,
that's why Nick isn't here.
He wasn't allowed.
But, I mean, I'm judging it on basically the melody lines and the vocal, and that's what I was looking forward to, because like I said, this is to me the best Paul Stanley era for singing, and that was a great, great vocal performance. Very, very, very good.
Yeah,
I feel like I'm Randy Jackson on the American Idol. Great, great vocal performance, dog.
It's I'm convinced that this was written for a movie that was to be titled Time Traveler.
What also makes it a little
bit... Nobody has corroborated that, though?
No, not yet.
But I mean, you agree with me, though. You can hear that.
Here's another reason why I agree. Because Time Traveler, it's a little bit awkward. Even saying, he's like, "Time, we're a time traveler." Like, it's it's not a natural melody. And if we were writing lyrics for this as a songwriter, you would not call it that.
Yeah.
It's almost like he's fitting that title into the song because that was the name of the movie.
There was an opportunity there. Yeah. What year was this recorded?
87.
86, 87, yeah, something 86. Like that. Yeah, he said he was doing demos in his apartment.
But he said that this was submitted for Crazy Nights.
Yeah.
So that'd probably be 86. Yeah, absolutely.
And it also makes it more impressive if he's recording this in his apartment.
I love the fact that Paul Stanley in 1986 was living in an apartment.
I know, right?
You'd think after playing stadiums for fucking 10 years in the 70s and all that shit. But
an apartment in New York City could mean a lot of things.
Good call. That's true.
I have a friend that lives in an apartment in New York City. It cost $1 million and he bought it. So.
Exactly.
There you go.
I just looked it up.
Yeah.
St. Elmo's Fire, John Parr, released 1984.
Ooh.
This is absolutely influenced by that. he wanted to have the theme song in the next Brat Pack movie. That's what he was going for.
Is a pair of wheels.
Yeah, I know that whole fucking lyrics, you know.
Wasn't that tied in with like some kind of a wheelchair Olympics or something?
Was it really?
I think so.
Wow.
Because it's called Man in Motion, Pair of Wheels in brackets, I think, or something like that.
Yeah. Gee, okay. Good one. Clever connection there, you know. It was like one time I was watching the Summer Olympics, and there was, you know, they were about to do like the swim meet or a swimming event, and they kicked in Bush's...
breathe in, breathe out.
Yes, exactly. Breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. It's like, yeah, whoever thought of that should be fired.
It's too obvious, but yeah, it's, you know, sometimes great. You got to just go with the low hanging fruit. But.
Oh, it's so good.
Wait, did you guys hear a knock at the door? No. Hold on. He's back. Oh, God. What?
I'm sorry to keep doing this, guys. Do you guys have half a zucchini on you by any chance that we can?
No, and no, don't put it in the chocolate either. Get the fuck out of here, garlic boy.
There you go.
Let me ask you a question. Did Nick submit all those for this show, or do you just have those on file?
There's a robot here. What do you mean?
Sorry. Oh, I see him now.
Nick sent the robot here.
I'm so fucking drunk, I didn't even see the robot in the room.
Yeah.
I apologize.
Yeah.
You didn't smell the garlic robot?
No, it smells more like oil. It's like garlic oil.
Okay.
Mm. Yeah. And I'll never be lost, 'cause I know that my road's lead to you. Last thoughts have been Richard Grieco. Since the light of creation. Nicolette Larson. Nicholas Sheridan. Sorry. Just imagining who would be in Time Traveler.
Yeah,
Richard Grieco and Nicolette Sheridan with, what's the guy's name? That was not Pierce Brosnan, but there was a guy that began with a P that would be the heel in the movie. I'll think of it in a second.
Okay. Well, I don't know if you guys want those lyrics, but you're getting them anyway. And I'll never be lost because I know that my roads lead to you.
Oh, yeah.
And our stars have been crossed since the light of creation was new. So how about that?
It's top level romantic stuff.
Richard Grieco.
Richard Grieco.
Nicolette Sheridan. And Powers Booth.
What? There it
That's
is.
What I was thinking about Powers Booth.
Nicolette Sheridan, by the way. We were at work. We were discussing Chris Farley movies. Beverly Hills Ninja.
Amazing.
Oh, my God.
She is so fucking hot.
Dude, I met her before.
Oh.
She's married to Michael Bolton, or she was.
Really?
And when I did some fucking show, I got to meet her, and she's so hot in person.
Oh, in that movie? Outstanding. Incredible.
So hot.
You know, other than that time we did the Vinnie Vincent song and I vomited for a day, the other time I vomited for several hours on vodka was while watching Beverly Hills Ninja in my parents' basement.
Such a bad movie.
Yeah.
So bad.
It's so bad it's good, though.
Yeah, his hair is terrible.
Yeah.
He's from Chicago.
What?
Sorry, he's from Chicago.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just wanted to say that. 8,000.
Give me those lyrics. I can't really make
it. Wow. I'm really loving the chorus.
Yeah, I mean. Who's better at writing a big, huge, stadium-filling chorus than Desmond Child?
You're right. For many different bands, right? Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Bon Jovi. I mean,
Aerosmith. Bon Jovi, Aerosmith, and Kiss really benefit from the Desmond Child. And then Ricky Martin, all those type of guys.
Yeah.
Look at Desmond Child's. It's funny. The other day I was listening to La Vida Loca came on, and I looked it up. Yeah. And it's written by Desmond Child.
I had no idea.
Yeah, and I text Paul. I said, how many huge hits has Desmond Child written? And Paul must have been in some bad Desmond Child movie. He goes, I'm sure you can find the information on Wikipedia.
Wow.
Look it up there. And I was like, okay.
All right.
Sorry,
okay.
Buddy.
Jeez.
Didn't mean it.
Thumbs down.
Yeah. Maybe Desmond pissed him off that day, and he was like, go fuck your ass, Desmond Child fan. Go ahead, Chris.
What was I going
to
say? Oh, the lyrics.
Right.
Was it the Your Love is a Light Up Ahead? That whole part again?
Oh, was it the same repeated over?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Your love is a light up ahead. So deep.
Yeah. Deep light.
So bright is what it should be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's this is 80s soundtrack stuff. I'd be interested.
I like the fact that you've called that, Chris, because I think you're right.
Oh, I know I'm right. I'm surprised that they haven't and that nobody's corroborated that. By
you know, if I was the president of the world, I would make Paul Stanley sit in for every episode of Pod of Thunder.
answer questions.
Yes, he would have to fly to Hammond every week.
Yeah.
When do you guys tape usually? Sundays?
Thursdays. Thursday nights. Thursdays.
Every Thursday night, Paul Stanley would be required to fly to Hammond to sit in on Pod of Thunder with you guys and give the real story.
That'd be great.
One time I asked him, I said, hey, man, I was like, dude, do you want to do a series of podcasts where we talk about all your 80s albums and analyze them album by album? And he's like, not really.
Really?
And I was like, okay.
Sorry. That would have been awesome. Is he just not into that period?
No, he is. He appreciates it. Of course he's into it because he was the quarterback.
Yeah.
He kept it going. But I don't think he's much of a nostalgia guy. You know what I mean? Like, he's done Alive With Me. He's done Revenge. He said that he'll do a Paul Stanley solo album because it's the 40-year anniversary now.
Yeah.
Right.
I haven't been able to get him yet, but... You know, it depends what kind of mood he's in, I think, you know? Sometimes people don't like talking about the past.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but that's the double-edged sword of being in such an iconic band that's been around for decades.
Well, and that's the thing.
You can't really avoid it.
That's the thing. And if you catch someone in the right mood, I'm the same way. If someone wants to talk about, you know, I just did a podcast about my debut in Chicago.
Yeah.
In WWE, YTJ, August 9th. And that was the idea, was we were talking just about that. So on that day, I was all about it. Mm-hmm. If someone else wanted to ask me about it, like now, maybe I don't want to get into it.
If someone walked up to you in the hallway and said, hey, you want to talk about, yeah, maybe not right now.
As I was getting eyes.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. So yeah.
I understand that.
Yeah. That makes sense. All right. Well, we still got a way to go.
Where are we at?
We're at 2:42. There's still 2:14
left. That's awesome. We still got 2 minutes of this left. I love it.
Yeah.
And a Bruce Kulick solo is coming up, Chris. I know you're happy about that.
I am happy about that.
Me too. The best guitar player Kiss ever had. I believe that to this day.
You know.
Who do you think's better? Ace? Vinny?
Yeah, I mean, no, not Vinny. Oh. I mean, it's a toss-up between Ace and Bruce. I mean, somebody else on a message board was... trashing Peter Criss at the expense of Eric Singer. It's like, it doesn't have to be either or. Just because Peter Criss wasn't the technician that Eric Singer is, doesn't mean he's a bad drummer.
Yeah.
Name a better recorded live album drum solo than 100,000 Years.
Exactly.
Tell me, name one. Yeah. I agree with you. And Ace has his own style that's a little bit sloppy, but so is Jimmy Page. Yeah. Bruce is not sloppy. He's very technically gifted. Right. Yeah. He doesn't have the charisma of Ace, but as a soloist, I think his solos are amazing. So I've always liked Bruce, but once again, as Paul says, it doesn't matter what floor you get on the elevator as long as you get in the elevator.
Yeah.
I got on the Kiss elevator in 84, and that was my era, was the Bruce Kulick era. So to me, I'm always going to be more attuned to that.
Yeah, but, you know, a lot of people get hung up on just sheer technical ability, and there's more to it than that for me.
Well, there's different styles of the band, too. You know, Bruce was the right guy for that era.
Yeah, totally.
Time is a healer. Time is a stealer.
Time is an angel.
Time is an angel.
Time is a devil that falls.
Fucking A, man.
Jesus.
Dude, play that back again. That last
time
line
is the devil what? What did he say?
Yeah. Time is the healer. Time is the stealer.
Yeah. Where's time is the feeler? I was waiting for that.
You know.
I mean, I was hoping that was coming next.
That was us writing the song. We need to know another word that rhymes with healer, stealer, feeler, dealer, peeler, which is Canadian for stripper.
Oh, wow.
I would have used that one.
Peeler? Really?
Peeler,
yeah.
I've never heard that.
Let's go see the peelers because they're peeling their clothes off.
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
You want to go back to Livin' La Vida Loca, one of my favorite lyrics of all time. She'll make you take your clothes off and go dancing in the rain.
Ooh.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm in.
I'm down with that.
I'm in.
You might not like what you see when I take my clothes off.
Let's ask the girl at the front desk that as well. Is it raining out? Please let it be raining out. What do you got?
All right. I don't know if this is right, but if it is right, it makes it way funnier.
There's no way it can be wrong then.
Okay. So time is an angel.
Well, let's start from the beginning.
Time is a healer.
Right.
Yes.
Time is a stealer.
Right.
Time is an angel. Time is a devil that flies. flying devil.
Time is a devil that flies.
That's what it says.
Time is a devil that flies. Let me hear that part again.
All right, here
that
we
is
go.
A hey, it goes with the delivery. That is a soaring vocal.
It's a flying devil of a vocal, isn't it? Yeah, it
is. You think
that's
it?
High as shit, man.
That's really
that's
high.
Amazing.
Yeah, I mean, again, yes.
Do me a favor. Go back to Time as a Healer and play it right through because it sounds like this is solo coming up.
All right.
That was a really cool part.
So you want to play that through and then listen to the solo?
Yes,
okay.
If we can
before
do that.
We get into that, and what the fuck was I going to say?
Tell me
damn.
About solos or feelers and stealers?
The hamster fell out of the wheel, huh?
Yeah, I lost it.
Damn.
I can't remember what I was going to say. I was going to say that for the flying devil, you know, war pigs, Satan laughing spreads his wings.
Oh, Lord, yeah.
He's been known to fly around if he has to.
Well, it's not that the idea of a flying devil is so ridiculous. It's the the way a devil that flies. That's what it is.
Yeah. The way. A flying devil, you know, a devil that flies. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. That is funny the way that's delivered. So we're going to listen to that through and then
and
carry
right
on
a,
through.
Right in a Bruce Kulick lead guitar.
That is a great transition.
Yeah, that's a good
the
one.
Way he stopped it was almost like an 8-track cutting it in half. Let's
time
hear it
is
right
an
there.
Age of the...
It's like, this is no good.
Here we go.
Guys, I'm really sorry. It's the last time, I promise.
Fucking robot, man.
You guys happen to have an egg white on you. Just one.
Yeah,
one
I got egg an egg white in my pocket. What a dumb idiot one. Garlic robot. Fuck off, robot. What a moron. Even kind of looks like Nick with that stupid face.
Sideburns on a robot.
That stupid face. Yeah, okay.
Oh, it's my favorite thing to do with you guys, man. I love it. Not a bad lead. Tasty.
Yeah.
Serviceable.
Yeah. I mean, he's definitely, you know, very melodic. He's got the nice blend of melodicism and flash, you know. That's one of his strong suits.
But this is when you can tell it's a demo because those drums are way too high in the mix. You can hardly turn the fucking drums down. Turn the guitar
well,
up.
Yeah, yeah. Ditch right. The John Parr drum pad.
Naughty, naughty. Yeah, loud and party.
I believe I'm a man in motion.
All I need is a pair of wheels.
Yeah, let's apply that to the wheelchair Olympics. That's a great idea. Boy, what a clever
all I need is a pair of wheels. Yeah, I mean, Bruce Kulick, man, you can't go wrong with that guy. He knows how to play the fucking fiddle, no doubt about
plus
it.
Plus that, you know, that epic arena chord progression. I mean, that just lends itself to playing an epic solo over it. So he rose to the occasion there for sure.
Once again, like I said, if they actually recorded this with some real drums, it could have been on Crazy Nights. I mean,
sure.
What's the vibe that doesn't fit?
I
like,
don't know.
I Fight Hell to Hold You kind of has this type of style to it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe that was the one they wanted to use other than this, but.
Time is a healer. Time is an angel. Time is a devil that flies. Oh, my time, trouble, oh.
Yeah. Paul couldn't resist.
That's always the best part of these songs when there's the like outro. A minute at the, yeah, at the
that's,
end.
That's, you know what? That's a catchy chorus. I really I like this a lot. Mm-hmm. And yeah. Just so you guys know, I looked it up. St. Elmo's Fire, Man in Motion. It peaked at number one.
Wow. It's a good on place the Billboard to peak. Charts. Yeah, going to peak.
Yeah. Yeah, number one on the Billboard Hot 100s in 1985, September. And it was originally written by David Foster and John Parr for the Canadian athlete Rick Hansen, who at the time was going around the world in his wheelchair to raise awareness for spinal cord injuries. His journey was called the Man in Motion Tour.
I had no idea.
Well,
there
and this you was go. The theme. Okay. And several members of Toto appear on the recording, including Steve Lukather. So there you go.
You can play the guitar a little bit.
Yeah. Not a bad, yeah. Kid is a good
well,
guitar.
And, you know, it was ended up being a theme song for a fucking Brat Pack movie.
It did. Go it figure. Did. It did. And let's bring it back to Time Traveler. Very catchy chorus. I like it. I can't believe I've never heard this before. I can't. You know, there's certain songs like this one, Sword and Stone, and It's My Life, Gene's tune.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard that one? Mm-hmm. Are you guys doing that?
We did that one already. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
How those songs never made it on the fucking records blows my mind.
Well, you're a little more in tune with that process than we are. I mean, what goes into the decision making in terms of what makes it an album, what doesn't?
Well, if you have a producer, he's kind of the boss.
Right.
I would think there's a lot of politics between Paul and Gene.
Yeah.
But when you're telling me that While the City Sleeps and Murder and High Heels makes it to an album,
yeah.
and It's My Life doesn't, it doesn't make any sense.
I agree.
I don't understand what the politics involved were, where Gene has songs on the record. It's a given. It's just the way it is.
Right.
And one of his, not one, it's not one of his best songs, but it's a better song.
It's better than other songs.
Than fucking Boomerang. Yeah. And, you know, While the City Sleeps and, you know, all the Dance All Over Your Face. It's a better song than that. So why did that not make it, you know? And this song, is it better than You Love Me to Hate You on Hot in the Shade? I think it is.
I would say so.
So why did this not make it? That
especially a properly recorded version of it.
Yeah, exactly. So
yeah,
who knows the real reasons?
See, that's the thing. It's like, yes, you want to hear what would have happened if they had the four members of Kiss at the time record
right.
this in a proper way.
If Eric Carr yeah. played on this, it would be much more powerful and you wouldn't have those... Because even if that was the beat of the song, he'd be playing it on real toms.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I agree with what you guys are saying. Okay, hold on. Hold on, no way, back it up. Okay, yeah. He goes full on.
He did.
Fargo, whoa, whoa, Fargo, whoa, whoa. Listen to it. Let's hear the little fade out there.
Right.
There's like.
He's still going, probably.
Riffing at it.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
You know, a lot of, well, though that's one thing that's kind of fallen out of favor is the fade out.
Yeah, I know.
You don't hear that too much.
On our record, Judas, I wanted a fade out and I wanted a sax solo. And I got vetoed on both.
Wow, that's a shame.
A good sax solo? Come on, man. Listen to Brown Sugar.
You know
oh
how
gosh.
I feel about sax solos.
I know you like when they say, CC, play that guitar for me, when they say the guy's name. Yeah. You like a good mama?
Yes.
Mama!
Announcing the guitar solo is good, but a sax solo is, you gotta love it.
Yeah, that's our producer said, no sax solos, because can we have a fade out? No fade outs. I was like, well, go fuck your ass then.
Now, the thing about fade outs, though, like with this one, is oftentimes as it was fading out, it's like, that was awesome. What was coming next? And then they cut it off.
You always either have a great vocal part or a great guitar part.
Ripping guitar
Here's
solo.
The two best fade outs of all time for guitar. One, Wherever I May Roam.
Okay.
Listen to that fade out. Kirk's solo continues. And there's a great little riff just before you can barely hear it. It goes, and then Tonight, Ozzy.
Yeah.
One of the great fade outs of all time. to where even when Ozzy listened back to it on the 30th anniversary, yes, he went to the studio with Kevin Jericho in Las Vegas, and they listened to the tracks,
yeah.
And Jericho kept it going to where the fade out, he had it cranked up, and he said, this is always one of the best, and Ozzy was like, oh, Randy was fucking just wailing here, man. It's so good to hear. That's great shit.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it always seemed like as the fade out was going on, it was like right before it ended completely, like, wow, that was great. I wonder what was going to come next.
Exactly.
Who knows?
Do you guys know the Stones song, Can't You Hear Me Knocking?
Of course.
So that song is 6 minutes long or 7 minutes long.
Something like that.
But the 3 minutes is the Can't You Hear Me Knocking, and then it goes into that
the jam
part, at the end. That was supposed to be a fade out.
Yeah.
But the dudes just kept playing. Right. Nobody stopped playing. And when they listened back to it, they went, this is fucking great. Oh, so they kept that extra 4 minutes.
That's a beautiful thing.
That's a beautiful
thing. You want to talk about some great sax playing on that
one. Oh, my God. Sax on that and Mick Taylor's is so good. So good.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Good. And that's,
see, on that we agree. Yeah. The Stones love. The Jones boys aren't fully on board with that. But, you know, they're kids. They don't know what the hell is going
right
on.
There. I got the logo right there. And I got Paul Stanley. I got the Loch Ness Monster with Paul Stanley makeup about ready to attack the Stones logo. That sums up this show.
It does. Why did you decide to put Paul Stanley's makeup on the Loch Ness Monster?
Because I wanted a Kiss tattoo, but I don't want the typical Kiss tattoo.
So you kind of made
something. And I wanted a Loch Ness Monster, and I thought, well, okay, dude, can you put Paul Stanley makeup on it?
Why not?
And it's did it, and that's like, because this my whole arm is based around music.
Yeah.
But it's not, it's very subtle. It's not like a band name or whatever.
Right.
And I thought that would be kind of a cool little homage. I showed this to Paul on the Kiss Cruise. He went, that's pretty cool.
That's it, huh?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty lame. Like, look at me, Paul. I've got a tattoo of you on my arm. Like, stupid shit.
Yeah. Well, it's time to vote, guys. Hell or hallelujah.
It should be hell or high water, shouldn't it?
I guess it could be.
I know it's been 212 episodes or whatever.
Well, hell or hallelujah is from Monster.
I know.
Monster just came out like the year before we started the show.
How does Hell or High Water go? Come Hell or High Water.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
We're going to love you.
We like this song better, I
guess. So this album came out a year before you guys started it?
The last Kiss album came out a year before we started.
Wow.
Isn't that crazy?
It's been a while.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this. When you guys are finished, what if Kiss releases another record like 2 years from now?
We got to get our asses back on the microphone, I guess.
You're like fucking Mulder on X-Files, so they drag you out of the closet.
Yeah.
By the way, congratulations to you guys. How many songs do you have left? 20?
No, I think maybe like 13, 12.
Yeah. You guys, is so impressive, and just not as a ask us anything, but like what an impressive thing for five some odd years.
Yeah, it's like five.
Every single song. Like that, like I said, like Paul and Gene should be sending you guys like a merch
like a
basket.
Fruit basket.
A fruit basket.
We'll take that.
No, dude, that's very impressive, man. I'm a big fan, but besides that, just the fact you guys did that, even if you don't like Kiss, just the fact that you had a goal and you did it and went through the whole thing, that takes a lot.
That's us.
Yeah,
I'm proud of that.
Yeah. We wanted to get to the end.
Was there ever a time when you guys, like, maybe, like, you know, 180, where you're like, dudes, I can't do this anymore?
I told this story. There was a moment where I thought Chris was done.
Really?
Yeah, when we did. So all the episodes, most of them have been songs, but occasionally we'll do a different type of episode, and most of the time we realize that's not for us, and we don't do it again. But one time we did, like, the Mystery Science Theater riff track style commentary on the Paul Lynde Halloween special.
Wow. I don't think I heard that one.
Because this is why.
Well, we did it, but we recorded it. Maybe it was 45 minutes or something like that.
Yeah.
And I, like, the recorder thing that we were using made a noise or something was wrong, or the time wasn't counting anymore. It froze.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh no. It didn't record any of the show we just did.
Oh, no.
And Chris was pissed off.
And you thought he's probably out.
And I thought maybe that was it.
But Chris isn't a quitter.
Well, that day.
No, I mean, trust me, the original version of that episode that was not recorded was pretty damn good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then we had to redo it. It
happens, right?
Yeah.
That's the thing about podcasting. It happens. I was at Paul Stanley's house.
Mm-hmm.
My fucking USB thing in the what do I
a little sim
what do I use Yeah, use I use a Zoom recorder. Yeah. And the thing just conked out like a minute in. And then this is Paul has like a little, he has this giant house and he's got a little kind of a chateau where he paints and he's got like a little man cave where it's big JBL speakers and it's lava lamps and curtains and shit.
Okay.
And I'm sitting there trying so hard to get this thing to start and it won't start. It's just circling. And I'm like, just give me a second, Paul.
He's like, yeah, no problem.
A minute later, panicking. 2 minutes later, and he's just kind of sitting there. And here's where you know guys have their microphone up like this, and then they do this. They put it down.
Yeah.
And they just put it on the fucking table.
Yeah.
And I was like, if this thing doesn't start working in like another minute, I've lost them.
Yeah.
I'm done.
Yeah.
And thank the Lord it did start working. But you then like we're slaves to technology.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, it's not your fault that the thing didn't record. You thought it was working.
Yeah. And it was up to a certain point and then it just decided it's corrupt now or it froze or whatever.
Yeah, and that's why it's like the fact you guys have carried through with all these episodes is really, really cool. Because like, you know, we talked about Kiss has a lot of great songs, but there's a couple stinkers.
Yeah.
You know, When You Wish Upon a Star. Like
it's more than a couple.
If you,
let's face it.
If you pulled up When You Wish Upon a Star with me, I'd be like, dude, I don't want to do this
one. I gotta go.
I'm gonna fuck off right now. I'll see you guys later. You guys cover for me. So I mean that's pretty admirable. Congratulations.
Yeah, and the other thing that's kept us going is I mean, we came up with this idea. I'll speak for myself, but I would be surprised if the Jones brothers didn't feel the same way. But
Jones brothers bullshit.
Yeah, right, exactly. I didn't think we were going to make it through the year because I was going to be like, well, nobody's going to listen
the
to
first
this
year.
And we're just going to get frustrated and we're going to quit. So why not shoot for the moon and claim we're going to do this whole thing? What's kept us going for the fact is the people like this show for some inexplicable reason. Seriously, the positive reinforcement we get from our listeners is what's kept us moving forward. It's fun to do it because people, for whatever reason, enjoy what we do.
Well, that's how we got to know each other. You know, that's why I'm here right now, because I was listening to your show.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I started getting into podcasting,
you were like, I got to listen to the best one to get some
ideas. Well, I was like, for whatever reason, and here's the thing. We might have talked about this before, but there's no band that has as many podcasts as Kiss does. None. Not the Beatles, not Metallica, not Iron Maiden, like nobody.
Yeah.
None. And for Kiss, there's so many.
Yeah.
You know, and that's when I just looked up Kiss podcasts, and I saw, like Three Sides, and I saw
Kistery Science Theater.
Those guys from Edmonton, which are great. They've stopped now. There's a bunch. And then I saw Pod of Thunder, and I remember like, what is this one? Oh, one song. How the fuck do they do this? There's no way. And I think the first one I might listen to was Masters and Slaves.
Okay.
From Carnival Souls.
Because
I always love that song. And just like, oh, I get it. Like you can get an hour out of this by stopping and starting. And then I just love this. Who's this sardonic asshole guy? That just fucking hates everything.
Well, that would be Andy.
Oh, right.
It's Chris L. And so it works, and it really works well. You guys got great chemistry. So every week, I look forward to seeing what your episode is. And now as we're getting down to the wire, it's like I'm almost sad because I was like, fuck.
Yeah.
Like, you know, what am I going to listen to every week now?
Well, I mean, we're going to carry on doing something. But that's the other thing is like Kiss is the only band that the three of us could do because we're equal fans of it. Like everybody says, and they're right, another band that would be great for this format would be Van Halen. Random, do the whole catalog, random songs come up. You get the Sammy era, you get a Gary Cherone.
I can dig that.
But we're not all three equal fans of that band, so at least one of us would not be fully on board.
But let me also take that to the next step. You're not going to be projecting to a fan base that is like Kiss.
Well, right.
Like Kiss, like I said, Kiss fans, Star Wars fans, and wrestling fans are a world to their own. Mm-hmm. For whatever reason, like, there's no band. Like, you could do this with the fucking Beatles, and you're probably not going to get the same ratings you get with Kiss. There's something about Kiss fans that will tolerate and listen and look forward to a podcast about one song.
Right.
I don't know a lot of bands that you could do that with.
Well, and the other thing that I've said this before, but the thing that I like
best about this format is that it's inherently about the music. You
yes.
know? Makeup bombs, jeans bullshit off stage, go down the list. What did we listen to today? You have a guy, Paul Stanley, stepping up to the mic in his apartment, recording right. that vocal.
Yeah, yeah.
It is about the music.
That's right.
And that's the thing that pisses me off about Kiss detractors. Saying they're a shitty band, fuck you with that.
Yeah, double fuck you.
You know, they're a great band. They've had their misfires just like any other Dude, band that's been around as long as
they have. For 45 years at this point, 40
yeah,
years.
45.
I mean, fucking tell me another band besides the Rolling Stones, honestly, that never broke up, that never stopped recording. I mean, Kiss, with the exception of the time frame between Carnival of Souls and Psycho Circus, never stopped recording records. There's no other band that can say that except for the Stones. None. Yeah. So anybody that wants to bag on Kiss can go fuck their ass.
Well,
all of them.
Again, you know, to say that they're lousy is just so ridiculous.
You hear it all
it
the time.
It might not be to your taste, and that's fine. But to say that they can't play or yeah. that they can't, that they're not good musicians, okay, they're not fucking virtuosos, but you don't need to be with this kind of music.
No, you just, yeah, you need to be fucking hitting the pocket.
So that's my favorite part of this format is that it's inherently about the music.
And let's go back to the music, Andy, America's Little Brother.
Voting time.
Here, time traveler.
Hell or hallelujah. Who wants to vote first?
I'll go first.
All right.
I'm going to give it a hallelujah.
Of course. Hallelujah!
Never was released on a real record. I would love to hear it on a real record, so I would love to hear Eric Carr's drums on this from the time frame, or Eric Singer if they would have done it in the 90s. But to me, like I said, Paul Stanley and Desmond Child have never had a misstep. There's never been a Paul Desmond song I didn't like. And my favorite era of Paul's vocals, and dude, he killed it. The vocals are so good. They're high. They're powerful. I really enjoyed this, man. I enjoyed the fact I'd never heard this song. And I'm super biased because I'm a Paul Stanley fanatic, but it was very, very cool. And I will, I don't know, can you even get this on iTunes? I don't know, but
yeah,
you can?
Yeah.
I will buy this on iTunes, or I will at least find it on YouTube and listen to it a bunch more times.
We listened to it on iTunes today.
I will get
That's
it.
That's where it came from.
Right fucking so, yeah. now. That's $1.99 in Kiss's pocket.
All right.
Which means they get about 30 cents.
Well, but on that tip, I wonder how many sales we've generated for them. I personally, from doing this podcast, and I still buy my music. You
yeah,
know?
Me too.
I'm not on board with the streaming thing. I like to own what I like to own. I listen to everything on Shuffle. Pay for my music on iTunes. Because of this podcast, I have purchased Unmasked, Paul's solo album.
Wow, yeah, yeah. Lick It Up?
Haven't gotten that one yet, okay. But I did get Creatures, and I bought Carnival of Souls. 1, 2, 3, 4, strictly because of
hearing
consuming the
yeah.
music via this podcast.
That's just you.
Which I wouldn't have done it.
But how many people listening have done the same?
Who knows?
Right.
But I will. Paul's solo album was a revelation for me. Doing it on this podcast.
Paul's solo. Take out Hold Me, Touch Me.
Right.
Take that one out. It's a perfect album.
It's a
Every
great
song
album.
Is a. We have a little I thing agree. That we do. I do with the guys from Avenged Sevenfold. Perfect album podcast. Hmm. To be a perfect album, every song has to be A- or less. Paul's solo album falls in that category, with the exception of Hold Me, Touch Me, which I don't like.
Right. Yeah,
little bit of a pandering ballad there, but
yeah, and the fact they released that as the single, but whatever.
Yeah,
Time Traveler, great fucking tune on as a demo, with Eric Carr's thunder drums on it.
Yeah,
yeah. So what are you giving it, Chris?
Not as enthusiastic as you, but I will give it a hallelujah.
Wow. Hallelujah!
Yeah, strictly for the, mainly for the. power of vocal performance and also, you know, the melodicism that you get from Desmond Child involved.
I'm not sure this is even a word, but I'm going to use it from now on.
Why?
Melodicism.
I think it's a word.
Really?
If it's not, it is now.
It is now. It goes in the Chris L. Wikipedia dictionary.
And also, but in terms of the negatives, I mean, the John Parr Association.
Terrible.
I've got a problem
that's
with
bad.
It.
That's bad. Yeah, that's
it is
fucking
bad.
Shit. It's very bad.
Like you said, the drum machine is too damn loud. Yeah, drowns out the guitar.
For
what's that Don Henley song that was big from that time frame in the early 80s, but it's not
Dirty Laundry?
No, it's not Boys of Summer, it's the other one. Sunset Grill.
Oh yeah.
Going down to the Sunset Grill. I'm missing you now.
Yeah.
It's like
That's what it reminded me of.
Yeah, and also, that's not a good connotation.
It also
either.
Said that Paul Stanley played bass. I didn't hear one note of bass on that song. It's all drum machine and guitar.
There's more bass on "Injustice for All," for Christ's sake.
They just re-released that 30-year anniversary.
And they still didn't.
Did
put
you add bass?
Bass
no,
it.
There's no bass.
Why? I read that he thinks it takes away from the drum sound. Is that his rationale?
Well, what I heard at the time was that Lars and James were at war.
Right.
And each guy wanted the better sound. And if you listen to Justice for All, the rhythm guitar and the drums sound is fucking great.
Yeah.
And as a result, there was no real estate left in the mix for anybody else. And Newstead.
I don't buy that.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's stupid. You can fit in anything you want. Give me a break. Others, we ran out of tracks. Fuck you. You're Metallica. Buy four more tracks. Sell a piece of your art collection, Lars, and put some bass on there. You know? I mean, I don't know. It's weird to me, but
I agree. I don't know the reason why. Still a great record, but I would love to hear it with some bass. Because Jason Newsted is a great bass player.
You know, but that's kind of a bit of a subject we've had through this podcast is odd decisions in the production and the song selection and the mixing. I mean,
if you guys were all huge Beatles fans, huge Metallica fans, Van Halen I would buy too. Those three bands, you could do this with them, but you'd have to be on the same wavelength.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and just I don't think the three of us could.
Yeah, and Nick doesn't fucking like anything. He just wants to stay at home and collect royalties.
Make zucchini things.
Let's give it over to America's little brother, Andy. What's your vote?
Yeah. Thank you. I'm also going to give this song a hallelujah.
Yes! Woo!
Remember, this song is a devil that flies straight out of hell, gets a hallelujah.
Devil that flies!
Yeah. Actually, I forgot. I was remiss that I didn't mention. I love the lyric, the sweat on my back.
Yeah, you're not letting that one go.
You've mentioned that a few times, actually. And you're not even drinking. You have mentioned that about 17 times.
But, I mean, I didn't mention it in my overall grading. I mean, I can't leave that out. That takes it up a notch.
So we're three hallelujahs. What happens now, Andy?
Well, does the robot get the vote? Let's see.
Yes.
Robots do not yet have the vote.
Oh, okay. Good to know.
Great. Get out.
Yeah.
At this time, there is no suffrage for robots.
I hope the robot returns for the last 13 episodes. He should have a weekly part on your show.
Well, I mean, we should probably keep him around. We can't just get rid of him, right?
Well, you spent a lot of money to make him.
It would be cruel.
You used all the money that you made off the Pot of Thunder advertisements and all that sort of stuff.
Pot of Thunder t-shirts.
T-shirts,
and stuff.
Yeah, exactly. The Chris Jericho GoFundMe page / Pot of Thunder.
Right.
Yeah. I made $100,000 for you guys in 2 weeks.
Wow.
It was good. Yeah, thanks.
That was cool, man. Yeah.
That's news to me.
Well, checks in the mail.
Yeah, okay.
All right. So what happens now?
What happens?
All right, Hamill!
I think it's that time, isn't it? Well, hold on. Yeah, it is that time.
Of course it's that time.
Yeah, is it that time? I'm buying myself time.
It's just the fucking way it is.
Anybody want any more pizza or anything?
I don't go for that shit.
No, we good?
By the way, we use that. I don't go for that shit. I showed that to all the guys on the Fozzy bus. We were howling.
They love that?
Oh, the whole interview. Continue. Continue the interview. I don't go for that shit.
Paul won't look at Gene.
Oh, so mad at each other.
Yeah.
They must hate each other in so many ways.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you can't not hate the other guy after all they've
been
through.
And then Gene says, my voice always works. Yeah, not like other people, that? Paul Stanley.
What's
why would you say that?
Where does it come from? Why is he doing
that's
that?
That's bullshit shit to say that.
It was enough. He's like, my voice always works. He should have just been like, I shouldn't have said that. I'm going to leave it alone. No,
Paul
like
Stanley!
Paul Stanley!
And then he has fucking Ace Frehley up there that blows the fucking whatever song they played. It was brutal.
Yeah. You know, we saw him at the Indianapolis Expo. And, you know, it's Ace. He gets all the respect from what he's done. He didn't give a shit. He didn't know the song.
Let me tell you something about Ace Frehley, okay?
Yeah.
It's the perfect example. You guys are musicians? You're a musician?
Yeah, a little bit. I can play a little bit.
He doesn't practice. I can tell you right now. Mm-hmm. He does not practice. You know what the guys on my bus do? And my guys aren't Ace Frehley. You know what they're doing before the show? They're fucking practicing. Yeah. You know what Zach Wilde does? 6 hours a day?
He's playing the guitar, isn't he?
Practicing.
Yeah.
He plays arenas with Ozzy. He's practicing 6 hours a day. You know what Ace does? Nothing. And you can tell.
He walks out there cold.
Nothing. Whatever he walks happens, out there cold happens. Gin. Yeah. He doesn't know the words. He doesn't know how it goes. He's right. Out of tune. He bends way over the fucking edge of what the fucking tune should be. That's my diatribe.
Right. Yeah, he's not right.
He doesn't care.
No, he doesn't.
He doesn't practice. There's a lot of huge bands that are headlining stadiums that do not practice, and you can tell
that's crazy
by watching them play.
Yeah.
And one of them begins with a letter. And the guy in questions, the initials are.
Yeah, okay.
Don't
yeah.
practice. You can see it.
Yeah.
It's sloppy as shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and Ace is like that. People, and that's why Paul and Gene don't go for that shit.
Yeah, they want
they don't
tight.
Want them.
Yeah.
Well, and he, that's, again, something else we've mentioned, Ace would look ridiculous in the outfit nowadays.
What would they do? Have two Aces, though? Is it going to be like Kiss Me's the Phantom of the Park with the stuntman?
Who knows, man? Who knows what they've got planned?
I don't know, man. I just hope Vinnie Vincent's involved just for the stories, for the drama.
There's got to be no way at this point, right?
Yeah, after what he just pulled.
That's right. Vinnie Vincent's kiss.
Yeah, that's... And then Gene... I don't have it in front of me, but Gene had some quote about how, you know... It was basically a nicer version of the Keys to the Kingdom speech.
Yeah.
Just about how this guy can't help
my
himself.
Voice always works. Yeah. Not like other people. Paul Stanley.
Sorry, did you hear me? I said Paul Stanley.
Paul Stanley. All right, Hamill.
All right, it's time for this next segment, whatever it's called. I can't remember. I got it. All right, we're good.
Are you getting drunk?
No.
You haven't called me Tooge once yet. I'm pissed off.
Sorry, Tooge.
All right, Hamill. Who's that?
Oh no, Michael Cavaccini got.
I fucking hate. What a that fucking asshole took over the bumpers too.
Well, yeah.
Why do you have to deal with this?
It's a legal thing. It's Michael Cavaccini's pot of thunder.
Hey, Google Jerry McDevitt. That's a high priced fucking ass kicking lawyer.
Okay.
That works exclusively for Vince McMahon. I'm going to get Jerry McDevitt on Michael Cavaccini's fucking ass.
Hey.
I want to hear the real thing. All right, Hamill.
We won't stop you.
I don't want to hear, I'm not Hamill. I'm Michael Cavaccini. Go fuck your ass. What an asshole.
As in the parlance of our podcast, blistering commentary.
I'm not happy with this Cavallini. Cavallini's a fucking asshole.
Well, I
man.
Like to call him Pepperoncini.
You know what? He's gonna get it. I'm gonna stick my.
He's
boot
gonna
up his
get
ass.
It. Wow.
Yeah, he's gonna get it. Wow. Fucker.
You gonna give him the Dicky Poncho treatment? I remember when you kicked his ass in the street.
I'm gonna give him the Jerry McDevitt treatment. That's even worse. Trust me.
You gonna put him?
I had a guy once sue me for $12 million. When McDevitt was finished with him, the guy was blathering on the street, pissing his pants, working as a fucking busker with a flute on the street corner of Fort Wayne and Hammond.
You're gonna put a McDevitt in his forehead if he keeps up with this shit.
I'm gonna McDevitt his ass. Hey, Cavaccini, watch out for the McDevitt.
Boy, the gauntlet has been laid down.
Big time.
This is great. This is what we need. This kind of defiance is
you guys, a little fire right
here. Well, you got to admit, we were caught by surprise by all this last
time. Listen, you guys in the home stretch, some asshole wants to trademark your show.
Yeah. Can you believe it?
I'm not going to allow that
to
happen.
Don't you hate these fucking opportunists?
As you might not like me, I feel like I'm a part of your show.
He's trying to benefit off the sweat off my back. It ain't happening. Yeah. You can lick.
Cavaccini thinks he's the sweat on Chris L's back.
You can lick the sweat out of my crack. Cavaccini.
Wow. Lick the sweat.
I've had it
lick
with him.
Lick the sweat.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm opening the folder that says do not use.
What? What'd you do?
All right, Hammond.
Yeah.
Do not defiance. Use. Do not use.
Yeah, they rearranged all the files on here.
Defiance.
Yeah.
Cavallini's pissed off right now.
Yeah, well, you be pissed off. Go ahead.
Where the fuck did you find Paul Stanley saying, "All right, Hamill"? Where'd you find that?
There's a bootleg from Hotter Than Hell tour where they're performing in Hammond.
Did you Google it? Or how'd you find it?
I think Nick found. Someone posted it on YouTube.
So great. All right, Hamill.
And it's like, oh, he says Hammond by name. Yeah, we definitely have to use.
It reminds
that
me when we were hanging out in Joylet.
Yeah.
Joyless.
All right, Hamill. This is the best. How long is this episode been going? 3 hours.
They all do. When
sorry. No. I'm enjoying. I don't want it to end because I've got nothing left. Yeah. I've got nothing other than Pot of Thunder. This is the highlight of my existence.
We've got nowhere to go, so
I've got nowhere to go. Are you guys staying over here?
Yeah, we're gonna stay today.
But you only have one bed.
Why did you have to point that out on the show?
Yeah, thanks a lot.
I was thinking, you know, you can reserve a room with two queens. You know, you can get two beds.
I've heard that.
Yeah.
I don't trust it.
Okay. Well, I guess you trust Chris L. Because
I need to snuggle.
Andy and I are going to have our own those aren't pillows moment after you're out of here. So.
Can you put your undies in the fucking sinks when he goes to wash his face? oh, gosh. Great stuff. All right, Hamill.
All right, so it's got to be good, good, real good.
I know what I'm going to say. I got my vote down.
All right, Chris L. Tooge's vote is in. Chris L.
Well, I haven't said it yet.
But you're
it's
right, in.
Oh, yeah, it's in. Yeah.
It's, like it's the in the box. Game. In the match game thing.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. I know what Chris L. is going to say. We're on the same wavelength.
Well, my vote's in, yeah.
My vote's in also. Now the important decision of what order are we going to go in? Do we go Chris L first?
I'll go last.
All right. Chris L, America's little brother, Tooge.
You get loaded. I want to see you throw up all over your fucking self.
Okay.
I think the guest should go first. That's what I think.
He doesn't want to, and he's the guest.
All right. Then
let him make the rules.
Let me ask you a question. I think that you and I are on the same page on this.
Do you need a sidebar?
I would respectfully ask for you to go first, Chris L.
Okay.
All right, hold on. I got to do this bizarre technique here.
How loaded are you, man? You've had a drink and a half. Do we have a fan bag after this?
A fan bag?
Fan mail.
Oh, we could. Yeah, we could. If you want to do it. All right.
I don't want this
to
end.
That would be fun.
Yeah, that's
I've got no friends.
We've got nothing to do either. We could do another episode.
You're my only friends.
We could do another demo from this era. What the hell? Whatever was that other
could
song?
Do a wild card episode.
Heart and the Biscuit or whatever he said. We'll do that
Let's do St. Elmo's Fire Man in Motion.
Let's honestly do
bonus
it.
Bonus episode.
All right. So Chris L., Andy, Tooge.
Okay.
Are we ready?
I'm ready.
I got to say not good.
Yep. Agreed.
Okay, good.
Thumbs up. Give me some love. Yeah. Definitely not good.
As constituted with the drum machine and, you know, the obvious.
Hold on.
Yeah, an auctioneer?
Yeah.
But, Chris, let's not get carried away. It was a cool tune. It's not a Kiss classic.
No.
If I would have went first, I would have said the same thing. Not good. There's no way, shape, or form it's a Kiss classic. It is a very cool demo with a great Paul Stanley vocal, great melody line, but it does not belong in the pantheon of the best of the best.
Agreed.
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 Yeah.
What was the last one you guys put in there that I didn't agree with? I texted you about it. Some weird one, like paralyzed or something.
It was not paralyzed.
We haven't done paralyzed.
That one's
yet.
One of like 10 or 12 still left or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. There was one that you guys did that I did not agree with.
Was it Tossin' and... No, we didn't do Tossin' and
Turnin'. Tossin' and Turnin'.
No.
He's Peter,
gonna,
what the fuck are you
talking
about?
He's not going to pipe up about a Peter.
Yeah, it must have been a while ago. We haven't had a classic. And
you said you texted me about it?
Well, we DM'd each other.
Yeah, right, right.
I'm looking for it right now. Oh, here, Kiss Podcast. Let's see what we got. Let's go back a bit. I always give you shit.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. I'm only back to March 28th. Thanks for the props to Billy Squire. Cut off midriff shirt. Bummer about the bus. I can relate. Which guy is you? Yeah. The skinny guy. See you in Joylet. Ascot was awful. We shouldn't have bothered with Ascot.
Yeah.
Oh, Fort Wayne, Indiana. That's us right now.
That's
you called it back in July, Chris.
Yeah. Yeah, I was
thanks,
looking
man.
Ahead. I can't find the song, but, you know.
Well,
that's another thing that's cool about when you do the music. It's like what really it's frustrating but fun at the same time. It's like when you really like something and then somebody else totally hates it. It's like, how can we have such disparaging opinions about it? But that's part of the fun.
But you can never put Time Traveler in the list of Kiss classics.
As constituted, definitely not. Now, had the four-piece band from that era done it, who knows?
Had Eric Carr played drums and Bruce Kulick played bass, it might...
right.
It might have been better.
I heard that. All right.
Gene never played bass in the
80s. No.
My voice is always great. Not like Paul Stanley. Okay, fucker. You never played one bass line in the 80s, so go fuck your ass. Actually, I shouldn't say that. Gene's always been nice to me. Edit this out.
Yeah, we're talking about a different Gene. Not that Gene. Well, hey, if you thought this song was a Stone Cold Kiss classic, I'm sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
So great.
Yeah.
The fact you guys got Paul Anka.
He's done a bumper for us, which, hey, credit where it's due. Mr. Cavaccini hooked us up with all of those great bumpers.
I don't go for that shit. All
right.
He's got connections.
I don't go for that shit. I'm not happy with Cavaccini. Go fuck his ass. But I was very excited about the Paul Anka bumper. Very good stuff.
You've heard that whole thing. The guys get shirts.
I've heard the Buddy Rich one, too.
Oh, those are legendary.
So great. So great.
Those are the
old school rockers just throwing it down for the band members, saying you motherfuckers.
Yeah, nowadays, you know, they would that if those tapes came to light, it'd be like, listen to how abusive he is. Let's
hashtag me too.
Yeah, let's end. Boy, okay.
I meant
let's end his career because you can't be that mean to people. Get out of here.
I met Bootsy Collins.
Oh yeah,
a couple years ago at the NAMM convention.
Cool.
Great, brother. I think we were sponsored by the same string company or the fucking string. I'm not a guitar player, so whatever. Whatever guitar strings we use.
Yeah.
Thumbs up to
guys.
Thumbs up to D'Addario.
Yeah.
I don't know.
You got a fruit basket coming to you from
there.
The,
you go.
And I was asking, he's like, yeah, he played bass for James Brown.
Sure he did. Yeah.
And he was like, yeah, man, James would like, if you're playing with him and you hit a clam, aka bad note, he would look at you. And if you continued the show, it was a 2-hour show, if you got looked at by James 3 times or 4 times or 2 times, whatever, 20 minutes after the set was done, James would provide you with a handwritten bill. You hit a clam in I Feel Good. You hit a clam in It's a Man's Man's World. You hit a clam in Living in America. $50 a pop.
Wow.
Yeah. $150. If you're getting paid $500 for the gig, $350. And James would tell you the exact song where you fucked up. That's some serious shit.
We ran a tight ship, man.
Yeah, it's super tight ship.
Hey, the guy has standards. He runs his organization the way he wants. You don't like it, get out.
Yeah, exactly. Because there's a million bass players that want to play with James Brown.
Right.
So, by the way, both of you guys have hit some clams tonight.
Do I owe you money?
Provide you both with my invoice, and I expect you to pay me.
Okay.
So you got the fan?
We can do that. I mean,
I think you did. I don't think you were prepared for that.
I'd like to hit that clam at the front desk, I'll tell you.
Wow.
I'm just kidding.
Boy.
I'm joking.
Hashtag Chris 2.
It's a joke.
Chris 2.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
It's a joke.
Yeah.
If we don't have any fan questions, we pretty much might be done.
No, we've got them. Right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we typically would do it, but hey, it's a special occasion.
It is. Got the Tooge.
I'm actually excited about this. To hear Tooge answering the Yard of Questions. This is great.
I'm really excited the fact that, like, I have nowhere else to go and you guys are letting me hang out with you. It's good times.
Well, what else are we going to do?
Yeah, we got nothing.
It's only 2:37. How long has this show been going? Is this a 2-hour episode yet?
It's probably there now.
Oh my
We're
gosh.
Probably at 2 hours.
Should we shut it down or what?
You know what? Let's take a quick bathroom break and then we'll come back with the questions.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
We could just shut it off.
No.
You don't try and patronize me.
No I want to do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
No,
but we're going to take a quick pause.
Yeah.
Pause.
You know, but I don't have to go pee.
Yeah, but he does.
Well, there are other people in the room besides you. I know it's
unprofessional.
Yeah. Gee. Now you noticed episode 280. Hey, wait a minute. These guys might not be the most professional.
It's my 10th appearance in the show.
Yeah, you should know.
Is there any more of that pizza over there? Go take a pisky. Yeah. Pause it and pisky. Yeah.
Yes.
Hi, this is Ace Frehley, and you're listening to Pod of Thunder. Don't touch that dial. We'll be right back.
All right, we're back. Oh, sorry for that break. I had to take a quick run to the restroom.
And I think I'm going to pee.
All right.
Think I'm going PA.
All right. So.
Oh, boy.
Dare we do a Yardo questions, guys?
Yes.
I love the idea.
Let's
have to.
I got nowhere to go. I need friends.
All right. Well, you got two.
You're like Richard Gere in An Officer and a Gentleman.
Thanks, man.
I got nowhere else to go.
I'm like Richard Grieco with Nicholas Sheridan. With the heel Powers Booth in the 80s drama Time Traveler.
There you go.
I'm with like the theme song written by Paul Stanley.
I'm like Richard Gere in a pet store.
Ooh. Gerbil?
Yeah.
Come on, man.
That was fun.
Is that real?
It can't be. That's got to be. Where would that ever come from?
Well, that's what I heard.
Everyone's heard it.
I also heard Rod Stewart passed on a stage and they
had to pump his stomach. We were talking.
It's like 3 gallons of jizz.
Who was I talking?
He wrote
about
that in his book.
Did he really?
He goes, "How many cocks could I possibly have sucked?
Right.
To have 3 gallons of jizz in my stomach where I get pumped."
Well, I was talking about that recently. That's one of those stories where you would hear it about different people depending what age you are. Like it was Rod Stewart. It was David Bowie. It was
John Bon Jovi.
John Bon Jovi. Yeah. I heard it about Lil' Kim. So that shows you where I was when that story was
going
on.
That kind of makes sense.
Lil' Kim's truth.
Okay.
Yeah, that's not much of a reach.
So much that your stomach had to be pumped. Yeah.
Aye.
All right. So let's do this Yardo, huh?
What is it?
Swing away.
Yardo questions.
Oh, what's all Yard of questions? Sheep.
That's what it's called.
Sorry. Your drum machine is better than Time Traveler.
It's not a drum machine.
Yes, it is.
It's a Roland drum kit, and it's a looped beat played by a human.
Is it?
Yeah.
It's
the same. Yeah.
The kit you used
on the theme song.
And on our original song.
Well, Nick played. Yeah, same kit. Yeah. But Nick
I listened to that episode.
You did?
You guys all had solo albums?
Oh, that one. Yeah.
Cool. I don't remember anything about it.
Well, I'm glad you listened.
I remember I liked Chris Hill's song the best.
Of course you did.
There you go.
I didn't listen to really yours too much.
Well, that hurt my feelings a lot. I'm going to take a drink. I feel better now. Okay.
You're right. Just a jewel in the rough.
Sorry. All right.
You want to show? Sorry.
This week's special Yardo questions comes to us from... I don't get this reference. One of you guys are going to have to tell me what it means. Marie Provost's dog. Who's Marie Provost?
I don't know.
I have to look it up.
Someone
look it up.
She owes us a lot of money. Let's just leave it at that.
Is that what it is?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
So do we have her dog hostage or something?
Oh, I would love to get that stupid dog hostage. That dog bit my calf, caused me stitches.
Wow.
Back in 2016. So that dog can go fuck his ass, too.
Yeah. What a shitty dog.
A Canadian-born film actress.
Who?
Marie Prevost.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. Was, did she do like a peanut butter thing with the dog?
No. Yeah,
she was from
no.
the silent film era.
Well, maybe she did.
Yeah. I know what you're talking about, America's Little Brother. And I know people that have done that.
Wow.
Why would anybody do that?
I don't know. Put the peanut butter in the...
you got too much
in
peanut
the,
butter?
In the Joe's Tackleberry.
Yeah.
And let the dog lick it up. Yep. It's only right now.
Yeah, not really interested in that.
Why? You couldn't be. I mean, you could be, I guess, as a guy, but not, we're talking about a woman doing it.
Yeah, news,
well, anything... Anybody wanting to have a dog lick their genitals, there's something wrong with that.
Yeah, obviously.
It's only right now.
All right. So, Marie Provost's dog. Question one. Name a vacation spot, activity, beverage, and an album. Strange what? Question. I know. So, let's just go one at a time. I don't know if this means good, bad, random vacation
name
spot.
What?
Name a vacation spot.
Turks and Caicos.
Chris?
My favorite's Jamaica.
Wow.
I'm a big fan.
All right. How about an activity?
Now, is this a vacation activity?
I guess
so. Are these all vacation-related things?
Let's say yes to make this question make more sense.
Okay.
Vacation activity that you may do in Jamaica.
Karaoke.
Okay, that's what you're going to do, karaoke and Turks and Caicos so
yes,
far. All right.
I did do that.
Yep.
I killed
you
it.
Did it. Oh, what you sing?
Fucking ass.
What didn't you sing? I know what you didn't sing. My solo song.
I sing a great version of Don't Stop Believing.
Wow.
Yeah. And a great version of Chris L's solo song.
You know what my karaoke jam is?
What?
Caribbean Queen, Billy Ocean.
Of course it is.
That's a great one.
Just
man.
Pronounce it like he does. Caribbean Queen.
That is a great tune.
It's three syllables when he says it.
That's heavy shit.
Yeah. The vacation activity, was that the question?
Yep.
The wife and I had a good time at our last vacation in Jamaica, the foam pool party.
Wow.
Where they shoot the soap suds all over.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And, you know, it was a good time. We enjoyed
that. Yeah,
boy.
All right. How about a beverage? Tooge, give me a beverage.
Vodka and cranberry.
Okay. Chris L.
Grey Goose.
Bev.
Vacation beverage?
Yes, sir. We're still on that one.
Jesus. I guess, you know, the alcohol-free pina coladas were going down pretty nicely back in my last vacation.
A little bit of alcohol!
All right, and an album. This is the last part of this question, so...
Wow, any album?
Well, like maybe something that goes with your vacation theme. Maybe in the mood for vacation, while you're on vacation, when you need a vacation, I don't know.
Kiss Crazy Nights.
Kiss Crazy Nights. Chris L.
You know what? I'm going to be a little pandering here to my partner on the right. Something else, referencing my last vacation at poolside in Negril, Jamaica, back in March. I enjoyed your podcast, the Ride the Lightning Master of Puppets album clash.
Thanks, man.
It was very well done.
Thanks, bud. That's cool. Does that count as an album?
Does today?
It's my show. I can count it whatever the fuck I want.
Andy, you got to fucking deal with it.
Yeah.
I seem to have lost my phone, too. I don't know where
really?
It is.
We'll it's got to be here somewhere.
Well, nobody stole it.
I doubt it. I highly doubt it.
Later on, you guys have to call me.
Okay. Question two. Peter Chris walks into a bar. Paul and Gene are at odds. One at either end. Who does Peter sit next to?
Paul.
Okay.
P. Peter knows who runs the show. He's going to sit next to the power player.
Chris?
I'm going to say Gene simply because bass players and drummers stick together. It's the rhythm section.
Right.
I think they can put their personalities aside and just connect on the music.
All right, part B of this.
Although, part. You know, Paul's wanting mouth is quite a draw, so oh, yeah. It might lure somebody
we
over
some
to that end of the room.
Are these questions from actual people? Oh, I thought you might
I don't know who they are, though. They're weird random names.
I thought you might have been making it up.
If I
make
made,
it up!
If I, made, if I made them up, this is not what they would be. Part B of this question. Ace walks in and falls down shit-faced. Who besides Peter helps him up?
Say it again.
Ace walks in the bar, falls down
shit-faced.
Who besides Peter helps Ace up?
Nobody.
Nobody.
They walk over him.
Step on him.
And if they have to relieve themselves, they might relieve themselves in his general direction.
Yeah. Chris?
Well, Gene has had Ace on stage recently. Paul did the free cover on the Origins solo.
Fire and Water.
I think they'd both step in. I think everybody would help Ace up. That's my.
I think they feel like Ace is like the drunken older brother. The drunken America's brother.
All right. Hey, guess what? It's time to play two. Hey, let's play two.
Yeah, boy.
Swing away. The loop's not long enough for when we veer off and...
You pulling another yard?
No, same yard. It's just so long. Our answer.
I found my phone. It was right beside me.
Hey, oh, okay. Weren't those three questions?
No. This is part B of question two. The ace walks in a bar.
Oh.
Thing. Okay.
All right.
So question three. We answered that one, right? You guys are done with your answers?
Yeah.
Okay. Question three. Would it bother you if Paul had backing vocal recorded help for the last tour? How about if they'd been playing Old Fraley enhancing Thayer all this time? Question mark.
That's the dumbest question.
Yeah, I don't even know what.
If he's asking, would I care if they use tracks for Paul's vocals?
Yeah. My would it bother
is,
you?
No, my answer is zero.
Yeah.
It's live rock and roll, man. You do the best you can, and if you can't do it, you have fucking tracks. Paul deserves it. If they're going to go up for another 2 years, they better use Paul Stanley backing tracks.
Yeah.
Because if they don't, it's going to be fucking bad news for the band and for Paul.
Yeah, it's all in the name of entertainment. I mean,
show business, man.
Yeah, exactly. Give a break. People get hung up on
that. If you
want
to hear Lick It Up, sung the way it was sung, then go listen to the album.
Yeah.
If you go to Fort Wayne, Indiana in 2018, and if Paul can't hit those notes or has a problem, you put fucking backing tracks on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you have just as much fun.
Dude, nobody cares.
Nobody cares.
Exactly. They're there to see Kiss.
Yeah.
We know Paul Stanley's one of the greatest rock and roll singers of all time. If he's not now, he's 67 years old. Go fuck your ass.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's...
You gotta fucking protect your brothers, man.
Yeah.
And do what you need to do to entertain the crowd. It's what you're there to do.
And Paul still does it better than anybody.
Of course he does. He's a visual showman.
Tell me anybody that goes to a Kiss show that is not satisfied.
It doesn't happen.
Zero.
Yeah.
Right. And you know what? He's not... He's not motivated by trying to please the people who would have a problem if he was using tracks. He's there to entertain the people who are just there to have a good time.
It's show business,
and not
man.
Pick it apart. You know?
Yeah. I want to see him fly from the stage to the middle thing.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
All right. Well, thank you, Marie Provost's dog.
Wow, this is
I don't even
food
know what that's supposed to be.
Yeah, weird shit, man. All right. If you want to submit your yard of questions, go to podofthunder.com, click that widget, and send your 1, 2, and 3 questions our way. That makes a yard where we come from. Right, guys?
Yeah.
Wow.
So where I come from.
Well, that's how we do it in the
Are
Midwest.
We done?
Yeah. This well, I mean, shit, I guess that's it. I don't know. Time to go home. I'm going to go to bed.
Are you going to go to bed? You have one bed.
Exactly. I'm trying to get in there first.
Yeah, he's going to get right in the middle of it.
Well,
fully nude.
You're fully nude right now.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm not going to put clothes on to go to bed.
You're pretending that you have clothes on. You have no clothes on. Giant pecs.
Yeah, thank you for noticing. Supreme. I've been working out.
Huge, supple ball bag.
Mm-hmm. It's called a heat bag.
I think the show is done.
Yeah, it probably is.
Yeah, I think we've gone as far as we're going to go with this episode. It's a good one, though. Interesting pull from the generator.
It was a very good one.
It was fun, right? We had fun.
So, Andy, as the host of the show, are you going to end this or keep it going?
I'm going to end it right now.
Please. The show is over now.
Thanks for coming, Tooge. Until next time.
There might not be a next time. Yeah, yeah. What's next, Andy? What's next, America's Little Brother? I don't go for that shit.